Good evening and welcome to the December 10th, 2015 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, chairing the meeting, and we'll begin by asking the clerk to call the roll of the school committee.
Ms. Blumenbaum.
Present.
Ms. Wortham.
Present.
Present. Ms. Ann Hennessy.
Present.
Mr. Dan Meyer.
Present.
Ms. Lisa Leonard.
Here.
Mr. Robert Moore.
Here.
Ms. Brenda Clifford.
Present.
Present. Excellent, excellent. And I want to thank guys, and I detect we have a lot of folks in the audience tonight, and I know they were here earlier for a special celebration for one of our departing members, and we have other members who are departing tonight. This is our last meeting of the term. Before we move on to announcements, I want to invite members of the public who wish to speak to come to the podium, and please state your name and address for the record, and you have 3 minutes to speak. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in the public comment period? Okay. So then we will move on to announcements. Are there any announcements from the school committee?
I just have one.
Okay.
It's just a generic one. I just want to say Merry Christmas to everybody, and Happy Hanukkah and Kwanzaa and everything else. But with the holiday seasons, the schools are busy. And talk to your parents, to your teachers and the kids, and get everything together and support your schools. Thanks.
Excellent. Okay. Ms. Minnick. Sure.
I can go now?
You can. I think Ms. Minnick wanted to make a statement.
Do you want me here or up there?
Wherever you'd like. I think.
Okay, I'll sit right here then.
Yeah.
Okay. So, check it out. I started doing something sort of because I could, and I kept doing it, because I could, and now they're giving me a party for doing it. Awesome! First, I want to thank the chair and the vice chair, the superintendent, the food service director, and especially the school committee clerk, Laura Judd, for planning and hosting the reception. I'm both humbled by the recognition and very grateful for the chance to see so many familiar faces from my years on the committee. I have asked the vice chair to confiscate the mayor's timer because I'm fairly certain I won't be able to get through my remarks in 3 minutes.
Sorry.
Actually, this is a very long thank you letter to a number of people, but I hope it will also serve as a glimpse into what it means to be a school committee representative and perhaps as a marketing tool for those who might be interested in the position in the future. Simply stated, school committee service is much more than the televised regular monthly meetings. It's an amazing learning opportunity characterized by a collection of experiences and relationships. At one time or another during my 25 years, I served on each of the standing subcommittees, curriculum, budget and property, and rules and policy, as well as the two now defunct ones, conference committee with the city council and coordinating committee with the school councils. And I sat on the capital improvements committee and the evaluation committees for two superintendents. I participated in several ad hoc subcommittees, including parent involvement and facilities use, and I chaired a transportation subcommittee twice. I represented the school committee over a dozen years ago on the NEASC accreditation self-assessment team, developing a mission statement at the high school, and was included in a sadly short-lived community service learning committee. I've served on search committees for several principals and central office administrators, as well as being the liaison to the consultant for two superintendent searches. I was a member of the school committee's negotiation team for, I think, 4 multi-year contracts. Additionally, my name is on a plaque near the entrance to this building as evidence of my participation on the JFK Middle School Building Committee that oversaw the large-scale renovation now over 20 years ago that included the addition of the community pool. Just as an aside, my son Joel was part of the lucky class of 2000 that lived through the JFK renovation as middle school students without ever getting to see the completed project, only to be caught in the renovation of the high school as they began their senior year. I also had the distinct honor of being selected by my colleagues to serve for 6 years as vice chair of the school committee, a position which affords deeper involvement in and greater understanding of the planning and mechanics of district operations. I am indebted to my predecessor, the late Dr. Lawrence Fink, for stepping aside, likely sooner than he might have wished, to allow me that opportunity. Finally, a couple of years into my school committee tenure, I volunteered to represent Northampton on the board of the Collaborative for Educational Services, formerly known as Hampshire Educational Collaborative. Time flies. I've been our representative for 23 years, serving as the chair of that board for the past 15. The Collaborative is a nonprofit educational service agency providing districts with high-quality, cost-effective offerings, including special education programs for low-incidence populations, as well as individualized professional development services, cooperative purchasing opportunities, data warehousing and technology services, itinerant services like occupational therapy and physical therapy, and professional learning communities for curriculum directors, business managers, technology directors, superintendents, and principals, and more. Comprised of representatives from member districts, the Collaborative's board operates much like a school committee, hiring a director, approving the agency's budget, and setting policy, but also provides a forum for discussion of topics of shared concern for member districts. As board chair, I was invited to join the Collaborative's delegation at the annual conference of the National Organization for Educational Service Agencies, which afforded me the opportunity to learn about educational trends, governance, and programs and services in districts across the country. I am grateful to the Collaborative's former director, Joan Schumann, for trusting me and including me, and I'm very grateful to the school committee for allowing me to remain as its Collaborative board representative for so long. One of the great rewards of my school committee service has been meeting so many smart, dedicated, talented, generous people. From them, I have learned about group dynamics, decision-making, educational theories, gardening, legal terminology, data analysis, folk wisdom, and more. If my math is correct, in addition to 40 elected school committee colleagues, I have worked with 4 mayors, 6 superintendents, and 3 interim superintendents, 26 principals, and almost that many assistant principals, 4 business managers, 8 curriculum directors, 5 directors of special education or pupil services, and at least 13 school committee clerks. Really, I don't think I'm all that difficult to deal with, but one of those clerks abruptly quit her position when I suggested a revision to the meeting minutes, and one had a heart attack while I was talking with her on the phone. She did live to tell about it. And of course, there have been many other central office and district administrators, scores of teachers, dozens of parents and community members, and city officials, all of whom have enriched my understanding of issues before the school committee and helped me to come to my decisions. I know that recognizing some of these people by name leaves me at risk for offending those that aren't mentioned. Please know that I appreciate all of you, even if you were lucky enough to escape being spotlighted here. Almost anyone that knows me knows I am from Texas. My husband, Terry, and I married at the end of college, and following his career, we lived in 5 different states over the next 12 years. Our daughter, Christy, was born 3 months after we moved to the Kansas City area. 3 years later, our son, Joel, arrived during a cold Michigan winter. By the time our family moved from Rhode Island into our Massachusetts home on New Year's Eve, 1986, I had learned that getting involved in something was the best way to meet people. My children moved into new classrooms midterm, Christy into second grade with Nancy Harrington, who would later serve as elementary curriculum coordinator for the district, and Joel into preschool at Smith College, with none other than Gwen Agna as his teacher. As soon as the moving boxes were unpacked, I headed to a PTO meeting at Ryan Road School, not knowing that meetings typically were attended by only the elected officers. I left with the PTO checkbook under my arm. The treasurer was going back to grad school and would no longer have time to handle the finances. The following fall, I was elected to my own two-year term as treasurer. 2 years later, I was elected PTO president. Halfway through my term, then principal, the late Walter Crowther, called me and asked me to meet with him. I spent several moments mentally listing what I might have done wrong that had gotten me called to the principal's office. Walter told me he had learned that there was to be a vacancy on the school committee. Because of a work promotion, the Ward 6 representative was resigning with a little over a year remaining in his term. Walter suggested that I consider applying for the open position. I explained to him that I wasn't a teacher, which he told me was a good thing. I later realized that teachers are wonderfully philosophical people, but that nothing would be accomplished by a board composed entirely of teachers. I further reminded Walter that I really had no educational qualifications for school committee, and he told me that I could get along with him, and that fact alone made me consummately suited for the position. I convinced my family it was a good idea and dumped my PTO responsibilities on the gracious vice president, the late Patty Samolevitz. By the way, that was just one of her many contributions to the students of Northampton. She was the welcoming face in the office at Ryan Road the first time I walked in, and we ended up being co-leaders of a brownie troop for our girls. She went on to be the school committee clerk, district transportation coordinator, and much beloved secretary at the high school until her illness. The digital sign in front of the high school was purchased with donations made in her memory, and her daughter Melanie continues her legacy working as a teacher in Northampton. My gratitude goes to Patty for her dedication and perennially upbeat outlook. But to continue my story, Walter suggested that I attend the next two school committee meetings to acquaint myself with district issues and procedures, and as an added incentive, he offered that he would arrange for one of the committee members to meet with me to give me some advice and moral support. One evening, a few weeks later, I opened the door to a charming, funny, devastatingly handsome young attorney, now a respected and still handsome, can I say that? District court judge, Michael Goggins, yes, he was a school committee member, guided me through the first few meetings following my appointment, telling me what was routine and what was a substantive issue. Mike and I sat next to each other for the following 3 years, and rumor has it that his wife, Kim, and her sister, esteemed ELL teacher and administrator in our district, Kathy Malinowski, would sit on the sofa at home, watching the monthly meetings on cable, rating our behavior, and conjecturing how Ken and Barbie, as they called us, would vote. Thank you, Your Honor, for giving me a good start on the committee and for letting me know not to take myself too seriously. We did, however, take seriously the issues before us, and there were several in my early years. Almost as controversial as redistricting the elementary schools and moving the sixth grade to the middle school was the decision about whether to accept the state's offer to supply condoms at no cost to be made available to high school students. Michael and I actually disagreed on that issue. In fact, the decision pretty much split down gender lines, and perhaps not the way you might assume. As the committee makeup at the time was pretty evenly divided by gender, the vote was close, and as usual, I was very undecided, seeing the validity of both perspectives, a curse that plagues me to this day. That may have been the first occasion of my being the deciding vote. Lesson learned, you can do the research, get recommendations, and listen to others' opinions, but in the end, you have to vote your conscience. It's what you were elected to do. One of the biggest opponents of providing condoms to students was the late Jim Dostal. I'm sorry that his recent passing means that he isn't here this evening and that I cannot thank him in person for teaching me that evening, for the first of several times, that we could disagree about an issue but still respect one another and leave the meeting as friends. I hope he remembered that lesson when, as vice chair, I appointed him to the Rules and Policy Subcommittee for his last year on the school committee. Almost every committee member had requested the Budget Subcommittee that year, and I thought it would be nice to mix things up. I didn't know that was to be Mr. Dostal's final year before becoming a city councilor, and that he had hoped to list among his credentials an uninterrupted 10 years of service on the Budget and Property Subcommittee. Oops. But what was done, and he took it in stride. Jim was an unflinchingly honest, dedicated, giving, and forgiving man. I'm lucky that I had the opportunity to serve with him. In recent years, I've been continually impressed by the level of awareness and preparedness of school committee members. I joined the committee prior to the time that state legislation required training for new members. That meant there was plenty of room for missteps, even with the best of intentions, and falling into the nurturing category on the Myers-Briggs scale, as I do, I'm always trying to take care of someone. The aforementioned Gwen Agna, by that time the district civil rights coordinator, helped me better understand my role as a committee member when I was contacted by a parent upset over a disciplinary issue at the high school. The parent didn't dispute the violation or the discipline meted out, but the timing of her son's suspension in the days just prior to prom meant that he would not be able to attend the event, and they'd already rented and paid for the limo. She wanted me to intervene with the high school administration. After my conversation with Gwen, I realized that while not listed in the state laws, one of the most important duties a school committee member has is to explain district procedures and help people navigate the system. I needed to make the parent aware of the chain of command and suggest possible remedies for the situation, but not involve myself in the interactions at all. I learned the lesson that school committee members have no authority except as a body, or if the individual has been authorized by the full committee to represent it. And the school committee is usually the final step in the appeal of a decision by the superintendent. So if a member was involved early in the process of a complaint, if it were allowed, he or she would have to remove him or herself from the discussion anyway. So thank you, Gwen, for saving me from myself. Interim superintendent, the late Chet Towne, was the first person to put everything in perspective when he showed me the wording on his superintendent certification plaque and explained that he tried to make every decision by keeping in mind the best interest of our students. And Michael Cosgrove often shared the same sentiment, albeit in his own distinct vernacular. Former JFK principal Dick Carnes made me feel respected and competent as a school committee member when, to further answer my questions about the middle school concept of teams, he handed me his copy of the Carnegie Report. But most of what I know about teaching and the ways that students learn came from Margie Riddle. She was a member of the Northampton School Committee when I first joined it and a respected teacher in South Hadley. She graciously described how small groups of mixed ability students interacted with and learned from each other, and helped me to come to grips with the idea of differentiated instruction, terminology I only heard several years after she described the concept. She left the school committee when the opportunity arose to teach in our district, and as one of the first Northampton teachers trained in mass investigations, she provided professional development for other teachers, district teachers in that model. As most of you know, she retired a few years ago as principal of Ryan Road School. Throughout all that time, Margie continued to be an educational resource, confidant, and friend. Of her many strengths, the one I most admire is her ability to inspire those around her, students, teachers, and colleagues, to be their best selves. Somehow, she is able to communicate her expectations for high performance while simultaneously demonstrating confidence in one's success in the challenge. Margie, I am indebted to you for teaching and inspiring me. I learned several lessons at one time from another committee colleague from my early days, David Dusso. David was, and I think still is, fairly opinionated and not always in sync with the majority viewpoint. Over the years, there have been several school committee members with divergent opinions, and honestly, I've appreciated that they made me re-examine my position, although it must have been difficult for them to feel frequently dismissed. But David wasn't lacking in confidence, and he did have priorities, one of which in the days before TiVo and DVR and network streaming was to make it home in time to watch Seinfeld at 9 o'clock on Thursday evening. By 8:30, the school committee was usually well into the substantive part of our agenda. It was almost guaranteed that, as the clock ticked forward, David would find the opportunity to make a rather impassioned argument for his position, then gather up his papers and march out of the meeting, leaving the rest of us with no chance to further debate him. I'm sure it looked very dramatic to anyone watching the meeting. Now you know the backstory. What did I learn from David? Know your priorities, speak your mind, and time your delivery for maximum impact. Early in my tenure as a representative to the collaborative, I was captivated by fellow Texan Margaret Collins' powerful presentation to the board on community service learning. Recent studies in neuroscience have repeatedly shown the connection between emotion and memory. I can't adequately explain it, although I do love saying hippocampus and amygdala. Basically, the idea is that students engaging in a service project that relates to a specific curriculum remember that curriculum better by virtue of the emotion they feel from involvement in helping others. There may be other benefits as well if the students learn things beyond a specific curriculum or develop a relationship as the result of a project. The concept can seem a little daunting to teachers who are reeling from so many initiatives and requirements, like just one more layer of things they need to do, but community service learning actually can be a great tool for curriculum delivery. Let me describe an example of a CSL project. Elementary students learning fractions met, along with their parents or guardians, after school to bake cakes. The cakes were cut into halves, fourths, eighths, or thirds and sixths, and so on, as part of the lesson on fractions. Then students delivered the cakes, now cut in serving-sized pieces, to the local soup kitchen to be served at dinner that evening. Cooking, which also involves fractions, parent involvement, math, and community service all rolled into one fun afternoon lesson by a teacher who didn't even stop to consider that it was a community service learning project. It was just a hands-on method to help students understand fractions. By the way, this project happened in Margie Riddle's fourth grade class at Bridge Street School, but there are many other Northampton teachers who routinely and sometimes spontaneously create CSL projects, notably Mary Cowie and Julie Spencer Robinson, and administrators who embrace the concept, particularly Leslie Wilson at JFK. Even though I will no longer be on the school committee to highlight community service learning projects when they pop up in field trip requests or school improvement plans, I hope that all teachers at every grade level will be encouraged to look for opportunities to integrate service learning into their lesson plans. When I say I hope that it will happen, I mean I'm confident that it will, because I always get my way. At least that's what I was told by Nancy Lippe. I think it's because I'm always right, but some might disagree. Nancy was the other half of the dynamic duo in the Ryan Reed office when I first walked in. She eventually became the school committee clerk and then school choice coordinator. And I would point out that she looks pretty great for a heart attack survivor. As the clerk when I was vice chair, Nancy and I worked closely together, grooming, guiding, and supporting several superintendents in a row. I greatly valued her perspective, her instincts, her confidentiality, and her writing skills. Thanks, Nancy. And thank you to the gentleman that rescued her as she slid out of her chair when we were on the phone that day, one-time Associate Superintendent of Finance, Joe Misterka. I don't know that there has ever been a more dedicated public servant than Joe. Certainly not one that survived on nothing more than a banana for lunch every day. I learned a lot from him, mostly in the form of idioms and adages, like one of my favorites, "You never miss the water till the well runs dry." But he also reminded me to have the courage of one's convictions, even in the face of criticism. Witness the still lovely terrazzo floors in this building, at one time referred to as Joe's Taj Mahal. My gratitude goes to former music teacher Noreen Tiley, who not only taught Christy to play the flute, back when we still had instrumental music in the elementary schools, but whose scripts for the unrivaled Ben's Variety Shows fulfilled my fantasy of singing and dancing on stage by allowing me to waltz, country line dance, get a little Bob Fosse, and sing What's Love Got to Do with It wearing a Tina Turner wig. Thanks also to former school committee colleagues Diane Welter, who routinely bolstered my confidence with an unexpected compliment, and Pamela Hunter, who seemingly always had the appropriate facts to support whatever point I was trying to make. And finally, and ironically, Francisco Palomo, whose frequent interruptions one evening when I was chairing the school committee meeting caused me to lose patience and utter the comment that was quoted in the Gazette the next day and will likely be written on my headstone, "Would you shut the hell up?" Yes, I learned something from that too. Last January, when I announced that I would not be running for re-election this year, I said I was stating it publicly so I wouldn't change my mind. When I began my school committee service, my children were in third and sixth grades, but for the past 15 years, I haven't had a child in the Northampton schools. There are two things that might have tempted me to consider running for yet another term. The first is that my older granddaughter started kindergarten at Leeds in September. I again have a very personal connection to the schools. The other is the opportunity to continue working with our current superintendent. He probably isn't infallible, but I continue to be awed by his data-driven and analytical, yet principled and insightful approach to the task of teaching and advocating for children. I believe John Provost is an inspired educational leader, and I urge the committee to give him its strong support in his effort for our students. So I know I lead a pretty charmed life. Terry and I have been married for over 40 years, and Joel and Christy have grown into interesting adults with whom I relish spending time, and amazingly, they generally seem willing to hang out with me. In other words, despite lots of pizzas on meeting nights, we all survived my civic involvement. Thank you very much to my family for indulging my endeavor. Serving on the Northampton School Committee for 25 years has obviously defined my life here. It has challenged me, introduced me to so many admirable people, offered countless learning opportunities, and allowed me to feel that I was doing something valuable, contributing to my community and perhaps making a difference. I'm pleased and honored to have had this experience, and I am indebted to my constituents for letting me enjoy it for so many years. Thank you.
So I'd like to ask the clerk to read that back from the minutes, please. Just want to make sure you got that. Okay.
Thank you, Ms. Minnick.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you for giving me the time.
Is there anyone else who wishes to make or attempt to try to follow that with any announcements at this point? Okay, with that, we'll move on to the rest of the meeting. We do have some recommended actions on our consent agenda. We have the approval of minutes of the school committee meeting of November 12th, 2015, the superintendent evaluation team minutes November 16th, 2015. We also have budget transfers that cover staffing changes and budget deficits. We have field trip requests, the NHS indoor track teams, winter festival track meet in Roxbury, Mass, December 19th, the NHS indoor track teams James Kelparis MSTCA indoor relays in Roxbury on January 8th, 2016, and the NHS indoor track teams boys and girls elite invitational track and field meet again in Roxbury, Massachusetts, January 24th, 2016. I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Approve the consent agenda?
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the consent agenda is approved. Next, we have reports and recommendations, and I believe we have a report from our student representative, although student representatives. So could you both introduce yourself to the committee and to the public, and then I'll have you deliver, whoever's going to deliver the report tonight.
Yeah, so we're actually both going to deliver it, but first, introductions. My name is Zachary Dietz. I'm a senior at Northampton High School. And just to give you a little bit of background of my role in the high school, so I am the Key Club President, which is the largest club at the high school. We're a community service club. I'm also captain of the varsity ultimate frisbee team. I'm a member of the improv comedy troupe at the high school. And I also, maybe some of you might recognize me because I have spoken there before on earlier school start time.
My name is Olivia Pruitt. I'm a junior at Northampton High School, and I'll give you a little background on myself as well. I play varsity sports all three seasons since freshman year. I am in part of a bunch of clubs at the high school, International Women's Rights Club, Model UN. I am part of the school council, and so I represent my class as well at school council.
Yeah, so in terms of an update, we figured we would split it so you don't just get bored with one of us. So yesterday, we were lucky enough to have a late start. Students really appreciated that. And another thing that's going on is, as I said, I'm the Key Club president. So just to give you a little recap of what the Key Club has done in the last month, they held a food packaging event, which was sponsored by local businesses, and they made over 9,000 meals for the Food Bank of Western Massachusetts. They held a dodgeball tournament, which was sponsored by our friends at the Northampton Prevention Coalition. The Northampton Prevention Coalition has been doing great work. They've sponsored the Key Club several times for several projects, and this particular project, they bought ice cream from Harold's for us so we could give free ice cream as an incentive to come to the tournament. And the tournament was a non-perishable food fundraiser, and we collected 187 pounds of food. The Key Club is having a donations drive this Sunday from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. That's going to be at the Northampton High School stadium parking lot. And we are accepting any clothes or books or small household items that are in good condition. That's 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. this Sunday, so we're hoping to have a big community turnout from that. In other news, Smith classes are ending next week, so I didn't mention this in my introduction, but I take two Smith classes, and for students, juniors and seniors at the high school, that is a very welcome time because it gives us a few weeks off between before the second semester starts. So that's something that students are looking forward to. The National Honor Society is holding a hygiene pack drive in coordination with a Smith College service group. So this group at Smith College is going to an area of rural Honduras in March, and they have asked the National Honor Society if they could collect hygiene materials. That's like toothbrushes, toothpaste, shampoo, combs, floss, anything of that nature. And so we have boxes set up all around the high school. If any community members are listening to this, they can contact any Northampton High School student and get those to the high school, and then we'll get them to the those Smith College students. The annual poetry slam at Northampton High School is coming up. It's been going on for years and years and years, and that's always a way for students to mark that holidays are coming up. That's next Wednesday. And then also, winter sports are starting now, and we have our first game. Boys basketball is playing tomorrow night against Amherst at the Cage at UMass. So that will be exciting.
So in other high school news, in terms of theater, we have a few really exciting plays coming up. The first are auditions for a student-written feminist play called An Itch in Her Teeth. It was written by two students. It's been in the works, I think, for about a year and a half now. and so anyone can audition. It's not specific to the thespians in our school. Anyone who wants to be a part of this sort of feminist movement is encouraged to go. Another...
When are the auditions? I mean, do you know?
Yeah, auditions were... What day is it?
December 1st and 2nd, were the ones that I saw on the marquee?
There were ones to December 1st and 2nd, but then there are callbacks, of course, and then I think there's a meeting about auditions in the next 2 weeks for anyone to come in additionally who wants to come and at least perform and discuss the sort of feminist role that it plays in the community. So auditions for Urine Town just happened. It's a political satire professionally directed at the high school. Every year there's a musical, and Urine Town is the musical this year. Also tonight in the Black Box Theater from I think 7 to 8:30, there is the beginning of a one-act festival. It's tonight, tomorrow night, and there's two on Saturday. It's a series of one-act plays. Some are student-directed, some are professional, some are things as popular as Shakespeare. The various trips that are meeting for next year, you know, students are allowed to travel, and so something that's been happening, especially in the past years, is doing sort of influx in fundraising for students who may not normally be able to go. So those trips include Honduras, Cambodia, Spain, and Montreal for chamber choir. I don't know if any of you heard about the potential walkout that was supposed to happen at the high school. I think it was 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
But students, led by the International Women's Rights Club, students were feeling that they wanted to stand beside a lot of what was happening, you know, at Mizzou and Yale and a lot of other universities across the country in terms of representing social justice and what it means to be in a community and how that fits into our school. So it was canceled, but what happened in place was meetings with our principal, and also there was a list of five sort of petition points, and those were more diversity in English and history curriculums, more LGBT-friendly sex ed curriculum, more diversity in the hiring of teachers, gender-inclusive bathrooms, and better sexual harassment policies and educations, more sort of everyone knowing about what's going on in the school. Those have been talked about. There have been meetings with the principal. I think that's about it, what's going on in high school right now.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that. Thank you that for that report and welcome. So we now have a presentation and a vote from the Northampton Education Foundation Small Grants, and Dale Melcher is here from NEF to present those.
Thank you. So I'm Dale. Can't see out of my reading glasses when I look up. My name is Dale Melcher. I am on the board of the Northampton Education Foundation, and I'm also the chair of the Small Grant Committee. Also on that committee is Laura Fallon, your representative to the board, and Laura asked to be part of the Small Grant Committee this fall. So this was a really exciting year for us. We did some very targeted outreach. We met with staff at each of the schools to talk about the small grant program, to answer questions, and to encourage applications. So in the be careful what you wish for category, this year for this fall, we had 22 applications requesting about $50,000. Needless to say, we didn't have $50,000 to give away, though we hope to work toward being able to do that. We are also in our second or third round of electronic application process. It still has some bugs in it, but we're working through that, and we're hoping to move to a fully online application process for small grants. So you should have in front of you the list of each of the grants and the description of the grants. For the record, I will just read what the titles of the grants are. So we have voted to approve funding and are asking the school committee to accept these grants approve funding of $35,278 to 16 applicants in our small grants program. The first one goes to Jackson Street School for something called Emotionally Responsive Classroom Study Group, a grant for $2,000. This is a 6-week professional learning community book study group for interested staff and faculty to retool, renew, and review current best practices in the field of emotionally responsive classrooms. The second grant goes to Leeds School for $1,370 for a stop motion animation project designed to engage fourth graders at Leeds in the design and creation of stop motion animated films. The third grant also goes to Leeds for year two of a residency with Tony Vaca, who will, in addition to leading hands-on workshops, lead an all-school assembly, a faculty workshop, and a cross-cultural art project between Leeds students and Senegalese students. The fourth grant goes to Ryan Road for something called Time Capsule Theater for $1,900. For this grant, the Pitti Theater will work with the two third-grade classrooms to create an original musical inspired by their Massachusetts and particularly Northampton history curriculum. The fifth grant again goes to Ryan Road. I feel like I'm at the Academy Awards. For $2,200 for something called Creative Forest Flags. Local artist Lindsay Fogg Willits will work with every class to create a series of flags that will exemplify values important to Ryan Road School. These flags will be displayed and be available to the school for years to come. The sixth grant goes to the Summer Reading Project, again at Ryan Road, for $2,750. In an attempt to address the summer reading slideback that many students experience, this project will provide struggling readers a steady stream of new and exciting books to read over the summer. The seventh grant goes to, goes to JFK, I'm sorry, I have the revised version, for $1,500. The JFK parent cafes will be for parents of sixth graders to have conversations about parenting issues coming out of parenting middle school students, and will build on the success of previous cafes focused on parents of preschool children. The eighth grant goes to JFK for $2,000 for Lego Robotics. This project will provide JFK students the opportunity to explore a variety of engineering and technology systems using Lego robotics kits and prepare them for the more advanced program at the high school, which NEF has also funded. The ninth grant is year two of a writing program. The writing program is longer than this, but this will be the second year that we will be funding, for $1,870 to continue the after-school writers workshop community for JFK students and to support their participation in scholastic art and writing contest. The 10th grant also goes to JFK for jazz experience for $2,000. The JFK Jazz Band will meet weekly with young professional area jazz musicians to learn different jazz styles and techniques, such as improvisation. The 11th grant also goes to JFK. We had quite a few applications from JFK. It was really quite exciting. This is for digital storytelling for $3,000. The Students of Color Alliance will work with facilitators from NCTV to explore social identity and develop critical media literacy and digital storytelling and media production skills. The 12th grant goes to the high school for $1,500 for Positivity Week. I'd like to note that this grant comes out of a student project, and it's exciting for us to fund a project that students are really driving. The purpose of Positivity Week is to create a safer, more inclusive, and supportive community through awareness and activities that will destigmatize depression anxiety, and other common mental health conditions. The 13th grant goes to the high school for the Technology Media Collaborative. That's a grant for $2,200. It will enhance the ability of students, particularly those interested in journalism and photography, to take photos of their own sporting events, theater productions, assemblies, etc., and share them with the school community. The 14th grant goes to a project that will reach all the elementary schools. It is another professional learning community study group on teaching numbers. We funded that for $3,000. It will build on the district work in math recovery and will fund a teacher group that will study and implement teaching number, advancing children's skills and strategies. The 15th grant is also a multi-school grant. It's K through 12. It's targeted at ELL students. It's called ELL Acculturation Field Trips for $2,000. It will use field trips to introduce ELL students to elements of our history and culture through hands-on experience. And finally, a grant that fell through the electronic cracks, but which we are pleased to also fund for $2,988. There's a $3,000 cap, and I love it that they asked for exactly what they needed, no more. This is Sojourner Truth's Florence, a walk through history. It will cover the history and legacy of Sojourner Truth through a walking tour, as well as classroom reading materials about her life and work, the abolitionist movement, the Underground Railroad, and social activism in 19th century Florence. So I hope you all appreciate the breadth of these projects. It's very exciting for us to support these projects. And the NEF is asking you to accept funding for these projects.
Okay. I would entertain a motion.
Move to approve.
Okay.
To accept the gifts with gratitude.
Is there a second? Okay, so there's a second. Any discussion or any questions about that? I know I speak for the entire school committee and the entire school community to thank NEF for its ongoing, longstanding efforts to raise money for our schools and to provide teachers with these exciting opportunities to do things in the classroom. So thank you very much for bringing it forward. And with that, I will ask the school committee to vote. All those in favor? Please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Ms. Minnick? Okay, I didn't think you were raising your hand.
Thank you.
Any abstentions? Ms. Minnick, did you have a question or a comment? Okay.
It was actually aye, but I was chewing. I couldn't say aye,
okay.
So I was voting.
Okay, so let the record show Ms. Minnick did vote in favor of that motion. You can have your cake and vote as well. Excellent. Okay, thank you very much. The next item is a first reading on a proposed naming of the NHS Digital Marquee, and I believe Donna Waterman is here to make a presentation to the school committee about that.
Good evening. It's nice to see you all in person instead of watching on our 47-inch screen at home.
Wow.
And I also wanted to say congratulations to Mrs. Minnick for her certainly dedicated years to the school committee, so thank you
very much.
The faculty and staff at Northampton High School would like to dedicate our electronic sign in the memory of Patricia Samolevitz. As Lisa mentioned in her address to you, Patty was really a driving force at the high school. She was employed by the school department from 1986 until 2009. She was the secretary at Ryan Road School, the school department receptionist, and secretary to assistant Superintendent Joe Masterka. She was also the Joy Winnie of the school department. She was the transportation supervisor, and she could be found on weekends at the DPW lot putting on the license plate for buses that needed to travel on Monday to make sure the kids got off to school. And finally, she was the administrative assistant at Northampton High School. In all these jobs, Patty performed her duties above and beyond those job descriptions. In fact, the job description was just sort of like an idea for Patty. She always went above on everything. Although she enjoyed all the positions, her true love was Northampton High School. As a 1968 graduate of NHS, Patty loved everything blue and gold. She carried that love into her role as the administrative assistant. Everything she did, she always kept the students in mind. She was truly the heart and soul of Hamp High. Patty served under six principals, from Gordon Noseworthy to Nancy Athis. She worked closely and survived the building and renovation that was completed in 2001. Patty worked to improve the NHS graduation and spearheaded the idea of Senior Week to make sure all graduates remembered their final days at NHS, things like the senior breakfast and the awards night and a picnic for the family. All that was her idea. It was important to her that every graduate be honored in both large and small ways, and that they would remember their final days at NHS. The entire NHS community was important to Patty. She planned many ways to show appreciation to the staff: Friday breakfasts, holiday celebrations, lunch for staff development days were just a few of the ways Patty made everyone feel welcome. Patty was the go-to person at NHS. Whether it be teachers, parents, students, community members, they all sought her out for answers, and she gladly helped. Mrs. Samulevitz also served the school in other areas. She was a member of the Ryan Road PTO, the JFK PTO, and the NHS PTO, while raising five children, all of whom graduated from Northampton High School. And as Lisa said, one is still teaching there, Melanie. She served as a board member for Volunteers in Northampton Schools and Dollars for Scholars. Patty was the driving force for obtaining the electronic sign at NHS. She knew the importance of communicating to parents and staff and the community. It was her dream to make that happen at NHS. We respectfully ask you to honor her memory, her hard work and dedication, and please let us name the sign in her honor. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to make a motion to name the sign in honor of Patty Samulevitz, who's done so much for our schools, and she really has been a driving force, and I do miss her in the office. And thank you very much for doing this. So.
You're welcome.
Is there a second? Oh, actually, I think this is the first reading, actually.
Oh, so,
so we're not taking a vote tonight. This is just the first reading. So we'll...
Five more times.
Really?
I think there's six total.
Okay.
It has to go through a process and be considered, but I don't think it has to, like, come to us six times.
It just... So this is the first reading, and we'll put it through the...
Just sit there.
The process.
Ask a question.
Sure.
Ms. Fallon.
So when you say naming it, is it actually going to say somewhere on the sign? Or
We actually, Raleigh, who works in the grounds division of the schools, has found a nice stone. And so we put that under the sign, and then we're going to get a plaque.
Okay, so it'll be on the ground, not on the sign.
Right, not on the sign. Yes, it'll be on the ground.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions from Mrs. Waterman about this?
I'd just like to thank whomever it was that came up with the process of wanting to honor her in this way, and I think it's wonderful. And just as Lisa Minnick's name is down there for perpetuity in the hall, I think it'll be wonderful to honor Patty like that now into the future. And I just want to thank you and whomever made that decision and put forth her name. I think it's a very wonderful choice. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Donna. Okay, I'm going to ask the school committee and thank you to our student representatives. I'm going to ask the school committee now to allow us to take an item out of order, because we have a school administrator and two city department heads are here to discuss item N on the agenda. That is a report from the Budget and Property Subcommittee, as well as a requested vote on a surplus of a 5,500 square feet parcel of land at JFK Middle School to the city for new Parks and Recreation Department building. So I want to begin, I think, by asking the chair of the Budget and Property Subcommittee if you want to introduce this, and then I can ask staff to come up and present plans and answer questions.
So we had a meeting yesterday, which was not our first meeting, regarding a possible siting of the Recreation Department on school department land, given the fact that there's an urgent need to relocate the Recreation Department by June of this year. What was presented to us yesterday was the use of a parcel on the east side of this building, and this would be a modular building that would be constructed within the next 6 months. Among the issues that we discussed was the mechanics of the transfer. The vote that we would be taking tonight would be to surplus that 5,500 square feet and then allow the city government to dispose of it. And of course, we know the current plan. One thing we discussed was that once the transfer takes effect, that we could not really create a mechanism in our transfer that would make it revert back to us. So it would be basically up to the city government, and I think that the mayor is going to address how that might be done, to transfer it if at some time in the distant future that the Recreation Department was no longer using that property, that it would come back to the school department for our use. Assuming that the transfer went forward, some of the things that were brought up was integration of that building and of the recreation department with emergency protocols for JFK Middle School. So for instance, if the middle school were to go into lockdown, that we would expect that there were coordination between school employees and employees in the recreation department, so that building would also go into lockdown at that point. We also talked about traffic counts and traffic impacts, and of course trying to make sure that the rec department's timed activity so it didn't interfere with drop off and pick up. Of course, we thought that that was something that probably no sane person would put themselves through drop off and pick up, and that the rec department would not, in serving the citizens of Northampton, put them through that. So, but it was something that we thought should be considered. Also, security and monitoring of the building. There would be a dead space behind the building because the building has to have a 15-foot setback from the property line, and that would be an area that would not be visible to teachers. So if students were on that athletic field in the back, we talked with David Pomerantz about how we might fence one side of it and screen the other side with shrubs in order to prevent access for any kids to be back there, as well as, you know, potentially installing whatever cameras needed to be back there to make sure that that was under greater maintenance. One of the things that was brought up is that, in fact, we have more sets of eyes on that side of the building because the Recreation Department employees would be back there, as well as potentially more police patrols, because then that becomes a city building, which would have to be monitored and made sure that it was not in any way affected. The other thing were maintenance impacts. It's most likely that utilities would be electricity, it would be provided through the school feed. It's potential that it would be hooked up to the gas feed from the school, or it might be propane. That's still something that has not been decided. And there was some discussion at yesterday's meeting about whether there would be any way to balance the additional cost. It was considered probably impractical to separately meter utilities. The cost of installing the meters would actually be greater than the savings. But if there could some way be an estimate of any additional financial impacts, that would be balanced out. And we also talked about mowing and plowing would probably just be continued and would probably be minimal impacts. And again, the last thing that we talked about with Mr. Pomerantz was that this is something that the school committee might want to address tonight, given and sort of take a final action, given the fact that there is an urgent need to relocate this, and that looking at the timetable that the Recreation Department and the City Services is looking at, they really need to start rolling in order to get a bid or an RFP and then get bids back and then actually get the thing constructed, so that the Recreation Department can have something other than a mobile van to operate out of. So.
Okay.
the rec-mobile.
Yes, the rec-mobile.
Excellent. And if I could just add, I know that I've been keeping, trying to keep you apprised of this. So we did work and looked at a number of different sites around the city, and JFK kind of came up as sort of one of our top locations, not only because of its central proximity to the city, but also because JFK is also home to a lot of programming that the Parks and Rec Department does, the Aquatic Center, gymnasium on weekends, all the fields after hours. They also run summer camps at Look Park during the summer, and then obviously the proximity to Arcanum Field and Safety Village, nearby. So we had looked at Arcanum Field as a potential location. Unfortunately, because of the way that land is in set up under state chapter land, it would be quite a hurdle. We'd actually require a two-thirds vote of the state legislature, first of all, to release any land there, and then we'd actually have to purchase land to replace the land that we would be taking up. So really came back to JFK, and I wanted to thank the superintendent as well as Principal Wilson, because we had a lot of conversation. We did a lot of walking around the grounds to really try to identify a location that would not interfere with student activities during the day and create enough of a separation between the city function and the school function, but would also be accessible. So with that, I do have the Director of Central Services, who's going to pass out some. Do you have the, Laura has the diagrams of what we're proposing. And then Mr. Pomerantz also has some large drawings that he can show you for the public that depict. Sure, as long as Dave can catch it on the camera, that's fine. So we worked with Berkshire Design locally to both give you an aerial shot of the school, an aero photo of the school, and then they also did some 3D modeling, massing modeling as it's called, to give you actually show you what it might look like. And I know Mr. Pomerantz has larger versions of that so that folks at home can see it. Yeah. Okay, excellent. So if you want to go to the podium, Mr. Pomerantz, and then maybe if you could just describe what this, folks can sort of see where it is, where the area in question is located. It's around sort of the backside of the cafetorium where the loading dock area is, right sort of almost at the edge where you enter the there's a soccer field there and near the tennis courts. Do you want to describe sort of what the project would entail and what this building would entail?
Certainly. Good evening, everybody. I'm Dave Pomerantz, Director of Central Services. So what we're looking at constructing here is a modular style building. These facilities are built in a environmentally controlled factory setup, stamped, certified, and inspected by the state, and shipped to the site. So we save time on construction, and it meets all building code requirements for the state. My department worked with Anne Marie and her staff and came up with a size unit about 36 by 60 feet, or about 2,200 square feet. Anne Marie feels that would meet the Rec and Parks Department's office, administrative, and class and conference room spaces. The building would be one level, about 10 or 12 foot tall, with a sort of a shallow pitched roof, handicap accessible, with two sets of bathrooms inside, kitchen facilities, so when they run programs, there's sink facilities, et cetera, for people inside the building. And it's handicap accessible on the outside with a ramp. We're looking at a gas-fired hot heating and cooling system. The heating and cooling units are mounted on the roof of these units, and we're probably going to be looking at propane, although we do have the option of possibly tying into the natural gas supply at JFK. We're still looking which way to go with that. We would be tying into water and sewer and the electric system the way Downey was talking about in his presentation, and we would certainly look at ways to cover the costs, the additional costs for those utilities for Parks and Rec. The building is located, as you can see here, there's a 15-foot setback that's required by the zoning ordinance, and I would have to appear before the planning board for what's called a site plan review to show them exactly what's proposed here. It's a flat site, water, sewer, drainage, and electric all run near the site, so tie-ins would be relatively easy. And we would probably end up putting bollards around the front of the building to protect it. The issue of security came up. There is a fence on the northeast side of the property near the soccer field end zone now. That would be relocated so it jogs around the modular, so we're looking at some sort of separation between the Parks and Rec building and then school space on the other side. And I would also look at probably tying that fence, a higher fence, on the east side of the building to the existing property fence to sort of close off that little 15-foot area behind the modular for additional security. We'd probably be looking at trimming or taking out one or two of the pine trees up against the fence. Those are school trees. And parking on that section of the property now, there are always vacant spots around the loading dock, past the loading dock, and on the sort of east side where you come in around from the Bridge Road side of the building. I think Anne Marie has, what, six staff, seven staff, plus some rec vans. So easy parking would not be an issue. And would look at putting signage at the Bridge Road entrance to JFK that would say City of Northampton Parks and Rec with an arrow pointing in. And when you get to the top of the cul-de-sac, so to speak, another sign directing you around towards the northeast side of the building for parking. Time-wise, I have to issue an RFP for quotes on the building, and we're looking at approximately 24 to 26 weeks from the start of the process to hopefully getting the building installed, finished, so Parks and Rec can move in. And with that, I'd be happy to talk about answer any questions about the interior of the building, how they're built, or any other questions you may have.
And I also want to point out, Emery Moggio, who is the director of the Parks and Recreation Department, is here as well. So if you have specific program, you know, questions about just how their office functions, what they do on a daily basis, she's also here to answer questions about that as well. I did want to pass around also a copy of of what the order that I would propose to submit to the City Council. I would actually, if this passes tonight, I would turn it in tomorrow so I can get it on next Thursday's agenda, and I'm going to try to get the City Council to take one vote on it next, to suspend their rules and do two readings at the next meeting so we can again get that RFP out. And basically, if you read, so after, assuming that the school committee were to surplus it, you'll see that we have the now therefore be it ordered clause. Toward the end of the order, we have language that says that the in the event that the city did not wanted to, you know, stop using it for parks and recreation, that they would need to seek the approval of the school committee for whatever other use they were intending for it. If it turned out at some point that the decided to no longer use it, it would be a vote of the school committee basically to transfer it back to the school department. Basically what's happening here is it's city property, it's under the custody right now of the school department. You would be relinquishing that custody, and then the council would be reassigning it to the executive branch to give to one of the city departments. But it could easily then just be reassigned back to the school department at some point if we decided to move somewhere else. Don't have any heart palpitations, Anne Marie. So that would be the, that's sort of what you're being asked. But we've tried to embed in this order, and I've tried to provide sort of the history in the order so that the school committee and the public and the history books would show that that's the intent, is that this is only for parks and recreation, and that any other use would have to be checked for compatibility with the school committee. Yes, Ms. Duvall.
I wouldn't have a problem with it if it were indeed only for parks and recreation and the people that were within the building. However, according, my issue is safety. According to schoolsecurity.org, that school access and visitor control, there's an expectation of safety. Access control to school campuses and buildings is a top concern for most school officials. School administrators struggle with maintaining a balance between having a user-friendly, welcoming school and climate and a facility which is secure from unwanted intruders. Okay, while even the best school access control efforts will likely not guarantee that a determined outsider will not be able to give access to the school, educators must take reasonable steps to reduce the risks of unauthorized access. I can't think of any place in the city where to put this would create, I mean, it creates quite a risk there. We don't know who's coming and going into the rec department. We already have national shootings. We had Sandy Hook. I mean, there's so much that could be so close to us that we need to protect ourselves without becoming paranoid or anything else. But to ask the schools, I mean, you said that there'll be additional cameras or staff. That the camera's not going to do anything once it's already happened. If somebody's determined to get on, then we've just given them access to get that close to our students. There's gym classes going out there. Did you want to say something now instead?
When you're done.
Oh, okay. There's phys ed classes going on out there. There's students out there that are going to be around. I never felt comfortable with it being at Smith School, and I definitely don't feel comfortable with it being here at JFK. I mean, school safety, we have to work to limit the access to people that have access to our students. It's scary as a parent and a mother of a JFK eighth grader, and even just as a community member, when my daughter goes to the high school next year, I still don't feel comfortable at all with not knowing whomever is going to be gaining access right next door to our schools, and I mean to our students, and to put it on school property, I just think that that's not right. I just don't think that's right at all, because we don't have any say as far as who is going to access the parks and rec department. And as far as knowing what's going on inside of buildings and everything else, I mean, thank you very much for that information. But, you know, as far as the internal buildings, that's a city government thing. That's a, you know, I heard the senior center didn't want it down there. And I don't know why, because of room or space or anything else, but with a whole city that we have the size of Northampton, why the only place we can find to drop a building, it's not like we have a surplus building, we only have surplus land, is to do it right out here at near my daughter, near my school, near the school. It's reckless.
Okay. Ms. Minnick?
Well, I certainly do not wish to minimize the concerns about security. So I admire and sympathize with your thinking on this, but you knew there was a but coming, right? But right now, there's access to the pool before and after school by community members.
Right, and we make sure, when we discussed that, we made sure that those people were out of the building by a certain period of time when we discussed all of that. I agree with you. I didn't feel extremely comfortable with that, but people are coming and checking in and they're going within the school. We know where they are. We're talking about people that are going to be near the school that, you know, I mean, Anne Marie and everyone's going to be in the offices. We don't know who is and who isn't. And like I said, once we don't have Cori checks on any of those people that are going to be around our kids. We don't know who they are that are going to be around our kids. I mean, you know.
What if the people whose property abuts the schools decide to have a party in their backyards during the day?
If they had it every single day of the year, I would have a problem with that. I would, you know, say, well,
that's
let's
their
see, let's,
home.
No,
it's their yard.
It's their home, but I would be talking about property. Having a I think we would be talking about safety at our schools, about, you know, look, they have a party, we don't know who's there, blah, 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 let's put up a bigger fence, let's do this. I'm not talking about, you know, policing the neighbors. I'm talking about making sure that we protect ourselves here. So if that was indeed an issue and they were having a party every single day, we just couldn't say, okay, today we got to watch for it. This is something we're talking about watching every single day. You know, and we were brought up that we're already, you know, we have the pool is a great example of the amount of talking about that we did here on the board, saying, okay, when will those people be out of the building because we have students we have to protect. You know, so yeah, I agree. The pool's a very good example of a problem that we have, but that we've been trying to address. We decided as a community. We're talking about people who are just going to drive in and not talking about the people that come with good intentions. We're talking about giving access to somebody who doesn't have a good intention and has easy access now. That's my concern.
You know, not to encourage bad guys or girls, men or women, from taking advantage, but front door is unlocked right now. I don't know about the side door. It was
right, but it's not during the day.
You know, like
students.
But if somebody wanted to come in here and hide out in the bathrooms overnight, they'd be in this building. I mean,
right.
You can take a lot of precautions up to a point, but I'm not sure that you can predict and anticipate everything. You just have to do your best.
Right, and our best is to take care of students.
The Recreation Department actually provides services for Northampton's kids. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, there's a part of me that feels like this is a city department and that they have, you know, that they're geared toward
children.
Right, but I don't have any problem with the
Recreation.
And like I said, right from the very beginning.
Okay, I'm done.
If it was the employees, if we could know it was only the parents, we don't know who's going to be there. That's the thing.
Ms. Fallon, and then I believe Mr. Meyer, and then I would love the opportunity to, at some point, to have Ms. Moggio describe the workings of the department and just what happened.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah.
I was going to ask. I'm assuming that the majority of people who are going to the rec department are, in fact, the same people who are going to the schools. They're parents of kids registering them for any of the programs or for the camps. And so those same people already have access to the school. They press the buzzer, they get buzzed in, and they sign in. I don't understand how this is really any different. I don't feel like it's putting our kids at any more risk than already exists. I don't. I feel like, if anything, having cameras and having an extra set of eyes on that side of the building that's really not visible from the street could potentially add to safety. I get what you're saying, that there's always a fear of our children not being safe enough, but I don't think that this.
But we're welcoming it here is my problem. We're welcoming.
But you're welcoming the majority of the people. You're
the
welcoming
majority,
are the same people.
Exactly, majority. How many people were out shooting in San Bernardino? Two. That's it. Maybe three.
But those
know.
Same
but
two people could get buzzed into the main office.
Right.
We need a place to put this. It's providing a valuable service to the city.
But it's not the school department's. Our job is to protect our students and to take care of and educate our students. Yes, it's a value. I mean, we've been members of the rec department since my daughter was little, and that's why she plays the sports she plays. I hold great value for the rec department, extreme value for it. I think Anne Marie is doing a wonderful job and has done a wonderful job for years. It has nothing to do about the personnel, the people, the anything. It has to do with the unknown and why invite it. That's it. Why invite it when I do believe that there are other places that possibly could hold the rec department if push comes to shove?
Mr. Meyer.
Well, I guess we did, obviously. Two of my sons are going to school at this building every day. I'm a teacher who I go through the lockdown drills with my students every year, and school security is an important concern. However, I would point out that we have control of access to buildings, but there are no security fences around any Northampton school department facility. That's not the way we work things. We don't have barbed wire fences around Northampton.
Barbed wire in a fence is different.
No, if you want to walk onto the grounds of Leeds, Bridge Street, Ryan Road, that access is not controlled currently. Now, if you are concerned in saying that we need to consider a change in access, I think that's unwarranted. I don't think you could ever put up a fence high enough. So what you have is you have a community institution, you have staff members who are charged with the safety and security of their students when they leave the school building. Kids at Leeds go down the hill to the stream with Mr. Ted. Kids at JFK walk down the street to Look Park. We live in a community where we feel safe and where our students interact with the world around them, where students go from Northampton High School to Smith, and they're not escorted by armed guards. Mm-hmm. So I think that your concerns are important, but I think that we've addressed them. And I think it's something that the school department is always taking seriously, security, and that's,
I'm sure they want
something that I don't think though, by not citing the building, that we're actually changing anything. And I think by putting the building there, when you say inviting, there's nothing to stop someone tomorrow from driving around that side of the building. Because
but if we see a car there, Downey, tomorrow, we'll say, that car doesn't belong there. If we see a car
when the rec department goes there,
we'll say it does.
If I drove my car around there tomorrow and parked in exactly the parking spaces that someone coming to get services from the recreation department because I needed to drop off my son's saxophone, nobody would say, look, there's a middle-aged man with a case. He looks out of place. Okay. Nobody would say that today. Nobody would say that tomorrow.
That's not so. And I agree with Lisa, who's going maybe, because I mean I've been over there and I've had people be questioned on the side, what they're doing over there if they don't belong there, and then they're nicely told that access is on the other side of the building and they're not supposed to be on there, and that's why they closed off Spring Grove and everything else. I mean, I am here and I've seen that, and I've seen that as an example. I just don't think we should invite unwanted people. I mean, people, we don't have control, you're right, and we can't live where we're afraid, but why invite the unknown right next to our kids?
Ms. Church, I have one question as we're about to hear from Ms. Moody.
Yes.
So the recreation department has been for a long time at a site that requires the people who are going there for services to pass entirely through the campus of a high school, and I'm wondering whether you ever had any kind of concern expressed for that access, whether the staff or the administration at Smith Vocational High School ever said to you that they were concerned that people were driving, a good distance through their campus in order to reach the building.
I've never had them interact with me with that kind of concern. We've had people coming down through the campus drive down for 15 years, so there hasn't been a problem that I'm aware of.
So do you want to just quickly give a quick overview of your department in terms of the staff and what happens in your administrative office and the kinds of programming you do around the city, but also with JFK?
Sure. There's seven of us that work in the office, so seven administrative staff. And then we have people in and out throughout the day, depending on the time of the year. Our busiest time is summertime, obviously, when all the summer camps are going on and things. Throughout the year, we're running programs in all the schools in the city, and we are running youth and adult programs basically in all different seasons. We have, it's not a ton of people in and out of the office. We are actually also going on to an online registration package that we've recently purchased, and that will even minimize the amount of people, which people like to do that. They like to register from home. So that will be coming live in the spring. So. That will, even lessen the impact of how many people are coming into the office, although we enjoy people coming in to visit us. And we have, sometimes we have meetings in there and different meetings inside. Those are nighttime meetings, usually in the conference room we have there that different groups in the community use, like baseball leagues might have a meeting, or our community gardens club has meetings and things in the evenings. But during the day, it's basically us in there. So I think most people that I see here have been a part of our programs and with their kids and as adults. So I don't know if anyone has any other specific questions to what we do.
The other person I thought I wanted to hear from is Principal Wilson, who has been part of this conversation over the last several months and walked the school grounds, and we've talked about this and tweaked drawings. And so it would be great to hear from Principal Wilson about her her view on this.
So obviously student safety and security of the building is utmost priority for all of us. So, certainly when this was brought to me, that was the first thing that came to mind, I have to be honest. So as we walked around some of the areas that we had discussed, we moved away from those areas for that very reason, and also how intrusive some of the places the building would be on our field space and where our students would be. The area that we've now come to talk about is as far away from kids and impacting field spaces as it possibly can be. And it's also going to be separate from the field space or anywhere on a typical day that our students would be. There will be a fence that will separate students from the rec department. I have to say that typically, if there's a car or somebody walking on our property, that person is usually identified and radioed in, and we find out who it is. So I have to say that the custodians and the phys ed folks that are down that end of the building and any teachers that are down there are really careful about who's there. So I didn't want to let that go by. We do know pretty much who's down there and who's walking towards our building. I think that we've always had a really good relationship with the rec department, and many of their programs are here, and we've worked together to secure for our students the areas around the pool, and I think that's working. So I think in that regard, the relationship with the rec department, you know, likely we will be able to make this work. There will be eyes around down there and more security, but there will also be more traffic down there. I think that if this is a good spot, we've done our very best to make sure that it will work for our students and for our school.
Okay. Any other questions? Ms. Mitt?
So just bottom line, you're okay with this?
I think it'll work. I really honestly feel like, it will be different for our school. With the building there, but I'm fairly confident. I'm confident that it will be fine.
Okay. So you're 100% confident that you yourself feel, we're talking feelings, not that you know the future, but you feel 100% confident that there's not going to be any problems whatsoever. Because like you said,
I can't predict that. There could be a problem here.
I said feel.
Right.
Everything inside of you feels this is okay. Let's go for it. Or is there a part of you that says, you know, I wish they had a different place, but we'll do it. I mean, that's all I'm saying. Do you, 100% of you feel, yes, not a problem at all?
I don't anticipate there being a problem. I think we will be fine with the building there. I'm always concerned about the public accessing our school area, and it happens often, and we address it. And I think that, you know, we're making it very clear what the path to the building would be, how we're going to keep students and staff away from the building and the public away from our students and staff, and I know Anne Marie and the rec department will help and support us in that.
I just want to say thank you very much, and I have total faith in Anne Marie and the rec department. I have total faith in you too. It has nothing to do with that.
Right. Yeah, we can't anticipate what's going to happen. I understand your concern, but I think we can make sure that we keep our kids and our school secure.
Right, but you know how right now when you have the people that are out there and you say that the custodians or the teachers, or that someone goes out and addresses them, whomever that is, you know, if somebody had bad intent, that would be stopped right there. Now you don't have that stopping because people will just say, oh, well, they must belong, and just kind of, it'll just start to become just normal place that they're there. And it only takes one. And then we're giving them access. So as long as you're comfortable 100% with letting it be on the school and you don't feel pressure to do it, because as a city organization, you know, the city doesn't say, what is the school's doing, blah, 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 before they make a decision. Why do we have to care about what the city's doing any more than already helping out with the community pool and, you know, offering the JFK fields and everything that is safety oriented, having it during the school day, just as you were concerned when it came time for the pool and having people in before and after in certain hours and how close it came to be when the students came in, et cetera, et cetera. This, we're just setting it up. I mean, we're setting up a situation that isn't really community building, because if the rec department went elsewhere, then it would be fine. We'd still have a rec department and everything else. I mean, it seems to me like it's a city council problem. And for them to put it on the schools and say, oh, well, because we have extra land, when we have to worry about the school, the safety of our students, I take it very, very seriously. That San Bernardino, what is wrong with this world when people don't really care when six shootings happen in, what, 10 days or something like that? And then we make decisions that are just going, that just don't feel right, because it's we have to learn from experience. And experience is that this world isn't the way that we want it to be. You know, there are people out there that could go crazy at any minute or have agendas or whatever. And I just think that, you know, why did you stop those people and ask them what they were doing here? Maybe they were just taking a walk with their dog. I mean, you know what I mean? I mean, I just think that there's not going to be that safety anymore. You were asking, and now you're not going to have to, because, hey, it's up to the rec department, and they're not going to. As far as every time I've ever been to the rec department, everybody's been inside the rec department. Nobody's been outside the rec department. I go in and I talk to them. They're very nice, helpful, and everything else. I just don't, and I support them 100%. I just don't feel, I feel scared. I feel very scared to have our schools be so close to the unknown and to welcome it in, as opposed to, well, you know what, the neighbors live there, we don't have anything to say about that. I mean, we have to deal with that as a risk. Going to Smith College and having the kids go down and walk down the street, if that's our culture and we want value education, then we have to deal with that as a risk. I'm just very, very scared. And the fact that you said that you already stopped people tells me that, you know, if it was such a safe world, then why would you stop people anyway? Just say, hey, you know, you must have kids going here, otherwise why would you be on the school?
Right. Well, and also referring to public who wants to come play tennis or any of those things, which we say can't happen during
hours.
Right, can't happen right. During school time. So, you know, there are people who legitimately come here for reasons and just don't understand what's happening. So, but we are pretty vigilant about making sure we know who's around our building and what their intent is and
up to
they should belong here or not. Sure.
Including bears, right?
Including bears.
Yeah. Ms. Fallon, did you?
I just wanted to say, when she says it's a city council problem, I just want to remind everyone, we sort of forced the city council into this a little bit by renewing the Fiker School,
right.
Offering to renew that lease.
I'm feeling it.
And I want to say, the city council actually hasn't had any involvement with
right,
this yet.
Right. So
I have to bring this to the city council. This is not something they created or, you know, this was actually your sister organization, the Smith Folk Board of Trustees, the other school committee in the city that voted to evict us.
Right. I'm just saying, so everyone has a part.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
I don't think it's fair to blame the city council for it.
Because they're renting to GCC for a nursing program. So I mean, again, the city council didn't have anything to do with this. I don't want to defame them in this process. Ms. Minnick.
No,
I'm sorry, Ms. Hennessy.
A question. Before school or after school, this field, is it a soccer field?
Out back?
Yeah.
Yep.
Do students hang out there without supervision before or after school?
No.
Or is it?
Okay. No. We have students who walk through that area to get to school.
Yeah.
We actually have students who come across the fields or down Spring Grove.
Okay.
But no, typically they don't hang out.
Okay.
But there are quite a few students that use that area. Cars can't go there. The kids walk by there because I see a lot of parents lined up on Spring Grove waiting for their kids to use that access to walk out. So we
right. Which we discourage because we have the pickup loop.
But
there are students that walk to school from that area, and you know, after school and before school would be there walking to school, but they don't hang out there. They hang out inside the building.
Sure.
Ms. Minnick.
So we heard from Henry and we've heard from Leslie. I wonder if we could get the superintendent's recommendation on this. Or never mind. No.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to put you on the spot.
Yeah, that's okay.
I did kind of, but.
That's right. I guess I would just talk to the process in the same way that Ms. Wilson has. There were at least two other locations that were proposed to us, both of which we found unacceptable, and identified alternative spaces for the sighting. In our ideal world, if you look at the map, there are sort of two islands on the opposite side of the access road. Our conclusion from that first day was, if you could put the rec department on either one of those islands, that would probably be the best place. We left from that meeting thinking that was going to be the resolution, because David walked out the space, and it, we thought it would fit in the second island where it's sort of partially located right now. That later on we learned that that wouldn't work because of the setback. When you add 15 feet, I believe it is, on the back of the building, it took the building out beyond the edge of the island towards the end, because that's sort of not a exactly parallel to the fence. It's sort of wider at that end than it is at the other end. And so then there was another meeting where the building had actually been staked out almost at the end line of the soccer field. When that happened, Principal Wilson called me right away with serious concerns, really about student safety, because of the sort of encroachment on the soccer field area and the fact that that whole space is used for PE classes during the day and kids enter and exit the building from that back corner. We made Central Services and City Hall aware of our concerns with that, and then we had another meeting where we came up with the idea of moving the proposed project as far away down that island as it would fit until we ran out of space. So the solution we have here sort of is halfway between what we would consider to be ideal and what the my preference would be if we could fit it on that original island. I think that would have been Central Services preference as well. This does provide us with some of the features that we were interested in. One was a clear separation between the rec department and that backfield area. The idea here is to move the fence and possibly enhance the fence between, I don't know, I'm going to call this the north end, although I don't know which way this map is oriented, and the soccer field. It's not ideal, but I have to agree with a lot of the comments that were made earlier about school security not being ideal in general. We do share space with the rec department for the aquatic center before and after school. We've worked out procedures that we think minimize the risk to students. One of the reasons why I advocated for integrating the park and rec department into our safety procedures at the meeting on Wednesday was because I think if they're going to be on our campus, there would be an additional concerns. You know, I think it would be important that they have procedures to notify us if they observe activity that seems to be unusual. I know from different interactions I've had with Anne Marie that they do perform similar background checks on employees as we do in the school department, so I think that that issue would be covered. There may be one issue, I'm sure there's more than one issue we'll have to address down the road, but sort of the one issue that occurs to me tonight as I'm listening to this conversation that we haven't had a chance to talk about yet is there are certain individuals who we're aware of that we just don't allow to have access to the schools. And I think it would be important to provide some kind of accountability for visitors to the rec department to make sure that they're not allowing those types of visitors into their building, because that would compromise our campus to a certain extent. But I believe they're amenable to having those conversations and to following the procedures that we would need them to have if they were to be located on our campus.
Ms. Minnick, do you have a question, a follow-up question?
I don't know.
Okay, you don't know. Okay, Ms. Hannes.
Yeah, I'm not sure who this goes to. When PE's out, students are out, door stays locked.
Yes.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions or Mr. Zahowski, did you have anything, any questions or?
Practical matter, if the school department is excluding individuals from school property, there's no access for them to this building except by crossing school property unless they climb the fence. So I don't know whether that's something that the, right, mm-hmm. as a practical matter,
And the rec department won't know until they're already in the building, and then they're already there.
The recreation department will have to work with you. They will, because those people couldn't get to the rec department legally. As soon as they are on school property, then police could be called and they could be.
Will anyone have to?
The way in which we normally would become aware of those individuals is when they sign into the office. So I guess what I'm saying is, if there are people who can't be on campus, they would have to know, and they would have to let us know, and let the police know if they were to arrive at their building as well.
I have a question on that. Why would they not be on campus? Is it, are we talking sexual predators? Are we talking about, we're worried about these people. So there are people in the community that we're worried about, and they're in the schools. So they have something to do with students or whatnot. So what are we worried about these individuals? I mean, if they're that, quote, dangerous, why are they dangerous?
So those determinations are usually made by a judge.
Okay.
I'll just leave it at that.
Okay.
So we're gonna. Ms. Fallon.
I just don't understand why anyone has to access the rec department once everything's available online. Couldn't anyone? Is there any reason someone physically has to come to your building, if everything is online?
Some people don't want to do online transactions.
But I'm saying we're not denying access.
But don't you have equipment pickup and stuff like that when they do it? Or
can't be in school.
Yeah, I guess that's what I'm asking. Is it possible that once everything is available to be registered online, that the actual number of people coming to your office is going to diminish, I'm assuming, greatly?
I would assume so.
What other reasons would there be to come by the office at that point?
Well, some people who don't possibly do online transactions would come by. Sometimes people have to drop off certain paperwork or different things. Sometimes people scan it and send it in. But, I think that, the demand for online is huge, and a lot of people do it. So we don't do, during the day, we don't have a lot of people coming in to pick up, like coaches coming in or, equipment pickup, I just heard one of you say, or something, things like that isn't during the day. That's at night, usually wherever the storage is, like over at Arcanum Field or something. So during the day, there's not huge groups of people that come in to the office.
When you say at night, so are people coming by after hours?
When we have a meeting or something at night, we work a lot of evenings. Coaches, that work during the day will have meetings at night.
But the coaches don't have access to the building, or do they?
No, in our office.
Right, so only you have access.
Right, okay. Right. Yeah, okay.
I just want to say that the people who are online taking care of business are the people online who have business to take care of. Those aren't the people I'm concerned about at all in any way. So, I understand that it's going to bring the traffic down.
No, I'm saying if someone's not allowed to be on school property, theoretically, they could register still for the programs. You're not denying them access to the programs by saying that they can't be.
All right. I thought you were concerned about safety. Okay, got it.
And just could you also just confirm what the superintendent said about Cori checks and things that you do for your?
Sure, all of our volunteers are Cori checked, and all of our staff that work for us are Cori checked, and we have some similar situations that you're talking about. So we would absolutely work with anything that any kind of regulations that the school needs to keeping people out. We'd absolutely work with them on that.
Isn't that an issue already if it's on school property now? The same issue, really?
Yeah, you're on the campus of Smith Vocational. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So this isn't something we haven't dealt with.
The new piece in the equation, if I may, is that instead of having visitors sign in solely at the JFK main office, there would also be some visitors who are signing in at the rec department office.
And with the physical campus here, what's to stop people from just driving in the parking lot at any time of the day?
But somebody like Ms. Wilson said will come and say, excuse me, well, now you're getting out of your car, or we see you sitting in the parking lot for 2 hours.
And do we think that we're going to stop doing that if people sort of seem lost? If somebody seems lost and they pull up and say, where's the rec department? We're not going to talk to them because we now just assume that they know where they're going? Oh. So we're still going to be, people are still going to be paying attention?
That was crazy.
Any other questions? Okay.
Mr. Meyer, I don't know if you'd be willing to. You have language. Yeah, I think you have.
So, in accordance with Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 4, Section 15A, I would move that the Northampton School Committee give notice that the parcel of land we have been discussing is not needed for school purposes. To add a certain parcel of land containing approximately 3,500 square feet more or less.
It's actually 5,500
square feet more or less, located parallel to the northeast corner of JFK Middle School building, directly adjacent to the northeast property line to the city.
Second that.
There's a second. Okay. Any discussion, Ms. Minnick?
So, it feels a little uncomfortable to do this without having more time to think, but I understand the need for speed. It also feels a little uncomfortable to do something when I feel like we have sort of guarded recommendations from the principal and the superintendent. But again, I'm going to trust you that other city property in this has been investigated and just isn't available or isn't compatible for some reason. And so these people, while guarded, as I said, they are willing to allow it to happen. And as the person who voted or who delayed the and extended the conversation over Fiker School to such an extent that it made it untenable and impossible for you to move the recreation department there, I feel a little bit of an obligation to get in line with what's being asked of us. So I guess all of those things considered, I would vote for this. However, I do hope that that we can make sure that the city council understands the desire to have the property returned to us if and when it's no longer needed by the recreation department. I would be reluctant to have some other city department moved over there. School department maybe, but city department I think not. And I asked Downey when this first came up, almost as a joke, I said, does this match with the architectural facade of the building so that it's aesthetically pleasing, since I was on the building committee for this building? And really, I was joking, but he said, oh, believe me, I asked, and he feels that it's not going to be a big eyesore, which actually reassures me a little bit. So I'm prepared to vote in favor of this, but I hope. But again, I think everyone understands this is not ideal. Mm-hmm. It's not ideal timing, and it's not ideal circumstances. But I think we are kind of in an awkward position, and I would not want anybody from the recreation department to think this is directed at them. This is simply, just a discomfort with the sort of situation that we've been handed.
And again, I just want to reassure you that we spent a lot of time looking at all of our city property, all of our city buildings, most of the other parkland that we have rec works on is parkland that's protected by state statute. And I know it's hard for people to understand why you can't put a parks and rec building on a parkland, but actually you're not allowed to. And the same, Florence Fields, we've had lots of questions. Why isn't it at Florence Fields? Can't do it. Mr. Meyer can explain that from the Conservation Commission perspective and from the grants that were used to secure it. You can do, you're allowed to build recreational facilities and fields and facilities to support it, i.e. concession stands, restrooms. But if you want to put administrative offices for the whole city, that's not allowed. We did also, one of the other potential sites we looked at that was Jackson Street School. And actually, Ms. Agna was supportive of that as well. And then I mentioned Arcanum Field as well. But this really, in terms of the siting and the location, and the relationship that already exists with Parks and Rec and JFK, this scene was the best site. Did you want to add anything to that?
I have a question, which I'm somewhat reluctant to bring up, but it's on my mind, so I'll just put it out there. Is it conceivable that the committee might decide not to award the RFP to Fiker and split up that lot?
Split up the lot. Meaning as an an alternative to this? I don't know. That's certainly,
Can you tell us where that is, Mr. Mayor?
Well, where it is right now is there's an RFP that's pending on the Fiker School building that December 18th, I believe.
21st.
21st is the closing date of that. To date, have you received any responses to that RFP?
No.
Yeah. Okay.
So if there are no responses, that would be available?
Well, no. What that means is that the RFP would be, the lease that you proffered and the RFP that you agreed to would go back to the drawing board. So it would be back basically to the school committee's hands to decide what it wanted to do next, including, trying to do a different lease or a different structured RFP, surplusing it to the city. There's a lot of options. Those are the options before you. Keep in mind, and you'd be back to the situation of you'd have a program that would be you would be evicting, the Naugatuck school.
No, they would not be signing it. We wouldn't be evicting them. They would not be signing the RFP. It's been a whole history there. They put themselves into this situation at this point, and we've offered them to sign it. And if they don't, then the school committee gets to decide again. But we wouldn't still not be evicting Naugatuck preschool. We wouldn't be doing it. The end of the lease does it. Them not signing the RFP does it, but we would not be doing it. I think that sounds awfully harsh for us to be evicting any little preschool, aren't.
Okay.
I just have one more thing to say, that I also feel obligated, like Lisa does, like she said, she's to say yes, but I also feel more obligated to the students. So when I vote no, I am voting vehemently no, and God pray that nothing happens.
Okay. The question was raised about Mr. Moore. I wanted to make sure that I answered the question about Fiker. I mean, there's an RFP pending, but it's for a very specific lease that the city council approved when you did the surplus vote and then sent them the lease. They are approving that lease kind of in advance of it being awarded. So then the only other option would be to reissue the RFP. We could actually reissue it, negotiate a lease, a different lease, and bring it to the city council, or you could take another path. I don't know. The issue, of course, is that we have to wait till December 21st, the scenario of Ms. Van Marie Moggio operating out of a van becomes more of a distinct possibility at that point. That's a superintendent vision. So that's the only other issue I would say.
Yeah.
And you can say that we wouldn't be evicting somebody, but the reality would be
they would be
needing to close the school and vacate. So I'm just,
And they should sign that RFP.
Whatever semantics you want to use, but that's what would happen. And again, the committee worked hard to try to, and I thought took a vote that they wanted to find a way to keep the system in there, at least till they could figure out what they wanted to do next. So I just want you to be cognizant of that. Mr. Meyer.
I just want to say that I take school security very seriously, both as a school committee member, as a parent of two children, as I mentioned, who are in this building every day, as a teacher who works in a building with locked doors and a security plan where all teachers are responsible for the safety of their children. But I do want to say that I just find it very strange the terror that we choose to live in. I mean, this building is locked during the day, but after school, there are still dozens of children in this building, and community members come and go for community activities. And that's because this is a community building. We don't live, and I hope we're not trying to live in a society where we have to fence off everything and we're afraid. Children are far more likely to be killed in auto accidents, and yet parents still pile them into the cars and drive them around.
So we still spend part of our budget on security systems for each of our schools.
I just think that we spend money on the budget for security systems to ensure against a risk. But you know what? We cannot have 100% security against all risks. That's not why we invite more risk onto the property?
Because we have a lot of citizens.
No, again, I'm not. I don't feel rushed into this. I don't feel this is a bad decision. I feel this is a service that's provided to the community members of Northampton, people that I coach and play soccer with, people that I might swim in the pool with, I might share the day camp with them at Look Park or at Safety Village. Again, these are not strangers. These are not the terrorists in San Bernardino. These are members of our community.
And that's what Sandy Hook said too? I mean, we don't know. I'm just saying it happens. I don't think that we should, I'm not saying shut off the pool. I agree with the pool. I'm not saying stop the community. I'm just saying don't invite the unknown when we don't have to.
Mr. Moore?
Yeah, I think I've got like tiers of things to talk about here, and I'm sorry for that. The first tier is just, you know, how does having a Parks and Recreation headquarters fit with being at JFK School? And I think the answer is it fits really well. It fits really well both in terms of the population served, and I think it fits really well in terms of, you know, the infrastructure that's here. People know where JFK is. People know, so if you're finding Parks and Recreation, I think it's actually going to be easier than it is now. I think it's too bad we don't have an extra 20 or 30 feet to our property line. There's some things like that that aren't perfect, but you know, we don't actually live in a perfect world, which brings me to the next tier, which is the risks. I think I'm pretty satisfied that the risks that are foreseeable, the risks that we actually can control in terms of the identified individuals or identified situations, you know, the kind of things that happen on a routine basis, I'm pretty convinced that actually, you know, we're doing what we can with them. And then that brings me, and I feel comfortable with it. I don't really think we could do much more to deal with those risks. Which then brings me to the next thing about the 100% guarantee thing, which I don't think we can do. And in fact, that's kind of, it's like the opposite argument. It's that the really bad things that happen, you know, the not just the little incursions, but you know, the really, really big bad things that happen are, as far as I can see, unpredictable. You know, they're random. They're not the sort of thing that happens enough that you could sort of say, oh yeah, well now we know, you know, we know the signs, we can do something about it. And so honestly, I don't see how this or any other sort of similar project has any impact on that risk, because that risk is truly unpredictable. If it was, you know, if any one of these really big bad things was connected to some other thing, you know, had a marker, well, we would avoid doing that. You know, we would avoid the press, you know, the thing which is the condition necessary for. But when you look at these things, part of why they're so scary is because there isn't an obvious precedent condition. It's not like, oh, the thing that happened before 75% of these mass shootings, and we've had a couple of dozen in the last month in this country, okay? There isn't any one thing identified before these shootings. In other words, there's really not much we can do. And because they are so horrific and so big, the sort of things we could do would completely undermine the whole point of our enterprise. I mean, think about all the shootings that have happened at various schools at various levels, and how most of the ones that come to mind, it was somebody who had already had a legitimate interaction with the school before that. You know, they're either a student or a professor, or, you know, you can just run through the list of things you can think of over the last decade of really horrible shootings. So you can't exclude the students and you can't exclude the teachers if you're going to run a school. And, you know, you do what you do, which is you query people and you pay attention and you do all that. That's what I was talking about, the predictable pattern sorts of things. But when something really big and bad goes wrong, I don't know that we should be doing anything at the level of trying to guarantee that we can prevent it. I don't think we can. And that's sad, and that's a little too bad, but it's also, I think, just sort of how it is. And so when I look at this project, I don't really see how it's inviting anything in that category to come. I think the thing it's inviting is more traffic, and I think in the general run of the things, we have systems in place for dealing with traffic and with those kinds of risks. So I support the plan. I'm sorry that we don't have a way to guarantee safety, but that I'm really actually pleased that it sounds like we actually have people paying attention to the kind of normal sort of things we can do for safety. And so I think this actually is a fine project, not perfect, but it's certainly not something to be terribly worried about either.
I have the superintendent and I have the business administrator, so I'll start with the superintendent.
I just think it's relevant to point out that we have a precedent for this in our schools. We have NCTV within our school. And I think that's been a partnership that's worked without any incident for a number of years. I think the level of risk involved with having another city department sharing the same campus is much less than with having another city department actually located within a school. So I think if we've seen that can happen without exposing kids to danger, it argues that we can probably have a more separated situation where we have a completely separate building on the same campus without exposing kids to any kind of reckless danger.
And I was just going to ask Ms. Moggio, do any of your staff have children who attend JFK, by the way? Yeah. So do you feel that your presence there is going to be a security risk for your kids who attend JFK? Okay. Ms. Walczyk.
Without prolonging the discussion on FICR, I think what I was hearing tonight was a misunderstanding of the RFP process. The RFP is not something we have sent to Nonotuck and asked them to sign and return to us. It's essentially a bid. It has a closing date and time, and it is very common not to receive anything until somewhere within a 24-hour window of that. So the fact that a reply has not come back from Nonotuck or anybody, I don't think anybody here should be thinking that we're most likely not going to get a response, so we can be thinking about options. It would be perfectly normal for any replies coming in to arrive that morning or right up until 2 o'clock when the bids close. So it's nothing we've sent to Nonotuck and they're procrastinating on signing. It is a bidding process and they have until 2 o'clock on the 21st, they or anybody who meets our criteria, to respond to that.
Thank you for that clarification. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sorry.
Thank you.
Okay, so there's been a motion put on the floor by Mr. Meyer. It's been seconded by Mr. Moore. Is there any other discussion or questions about it? Okay, so all those.
Laura has a hand.
I just have one quick
question.
Sure,
no problem.
If
no problem.
For any chance no one did respond to that RFP, would that change this for you? I mean, potentially, what do we do then?
Well, I think what you would do then is it would be back in the school committee's hands, because the approval you got from the city council was for a very specific lease that was part of that RFP. So if you would have to, basically would come back to the school committee and you would have to determine what to do next, including either, you know, devising some different lease and issuing a new RFP, or you could surplus it to the city. And
but
then
you have gone too far with this by then?
Well, that's the...
So what's the date the city council will have signed off on this?
Well, I'm hoping to bring it to them for next week before the close of their term. You know, this is the last meeting of your term. I'd like to bring it to them for their last meeting of their term so that we can begin the design and RFP process over the winter time. Because otherwise, everything stops.
Right.
And all of the, you know, inauguration has to happen, and the new committees have to be appointed, and new committees have to meet and form, and you know, so that whole process would have to take place, both for the school committee and the city council. I mean, clearly there's, you know, we're going to be going out to bid for the. Going out to bid for the modular construction,
an
RFP. So we'd issue an RFP with the specific specs and all those kinds of things. What's the time frame that you think you would want to be issuing that, Mr. Pomerantz?
Ideally, I'd like to be looking at January.
Okay.
First.
And then, so when would bids be due? Typically,
2 weeks after that.
Okay.
Contract phase, and look at early spring construction.
So that pushes us into like late January, February, that we'd be making more decisions about it. So that's kind of where we are. Obviously, nothing will have been, you know, built, although we are going to be spending engineering dollars and spending dollars to have everything designed and preparation for it. So that's the best I can tell you. Other questions or comments about it? Okay, so the motion was made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Those opposed?
No.
Any abstentions? Okay, the motion carries. And thank you to Principal Wilson, Mr. Pomerantz, and Anne-Marie Moggio for being here tonight. Thank you. Okay. We'll now move back up to the regular order of the agenda, and we have a report, might be the final report, from the chair of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee, Lisa Minnick. And this is on a physical restraint policy, JKB, revision. And I'll turn the floor over to the chair of the Rules and Policy Subcommittee.
All right. So this came to you for its first reading last month. It's back this month. I haven't heard from anyone. Just to refresh your memory, what we have currently is something called physical restraint procedures, which really should be a supporting document to a policy, not a policy on its own. And I think it was actually filed as such. The actual physical restraint policy that we had was the first paragraph that's listed, you know, on your, but I don't know if you've got the ones that have lines through them, but this much of the first paragraph has now been deleted. So the first couple of sentences are there, and the rest of it is all new, written by Laurie Arcus to line up with new state regulations that will take effect in January. So the only change to what you see, and I don't know whether Laura has changed it, yes. It shows that we looked at amending the suggested new policy so that it would say in audio format rather than on audio tape, because we don't have audio tapes anymore. We have some other kind of recording device. So other than that, just to make the language a little bit more current with today's technology. Other than that, the policy is as it was recommended by Lori, and the Rules and Policy Committee looked at it and recommended this, recommended approval. So I would move, and the Rules and Policy Committee recommends approval of the physical restraint and behavior support policy as written.
Second.
Okay.
Presented. I have a question about it.
Okay.
The very end where it says approved by the Northampton School Committee November 2001, this is a whole new policy, the very end of the thing. Is that, when does the date on that change? I mean, because this is a new policy, so.
It's not actually a new policy. This was the original policy.
Okay.
This much of it has been deleted. This is all that remained of the old policy. All of this part is new, but we did have a policy that was approved then. This new revised policy will have the new date listed as soon as we approve it.
So this is kind of like a morph right now. It's in between stage is all. Oh, okay, got it. Thanks.
Okay, Mr. Moore.
So this is not to the policy. I just a question I'm triggered by it. How frequent are restraints?
It depends upon the type of program. So in our district, in the behavior programs and the autism programs, depending on what's happening with the students at the particular time, the frequency of restraint can run anywhere from a couple of times a week to just about every day. With the exception of those two programs, physical restraint is extremely rare. It's on the order of maybe once a year.
Any other questions about the policy before we take a vote to approve it as revised? Okay, hearing none, all those in favor of approving this policy revision, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Excuse me? The motion was made by Ms. Minnick and seconded by Ms. Duvall.
What about the amendment? What? No, I do want to amend it, but I think because we hadn't ever really voted on it, I don't know. I sort of...
Oh, the audio tape one?
Yeah. I mean, what do you all think? If you want to undo what we just did and have that be an official amendment, or do you think that revising audio tape to read audio something or another is kind of just semantics?
I defer to you, Ms.
You mean like audio recorded because we don't record on tape anymore?
Suggesting it, that we amend to in audio format rather than audio tape. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I mean, to my mind, that's really just kind of splitting hairs, and I think that... Mm-hmm.
Well, we just voted to approve policy, so we'll have to go
so we
back
could undo
time.
That and, yeah. and put into place and motion to amend if we really need to take it that seriously.
But what does that mean? So when you say audio format, is that just I can leave you a voicemail?
I think it just recognizes that people don't audio on tape anymore, that it's more of a digitalized format.
But I meant if we make the policy read audio format, I think that might be unclear. Because to me, audio format is I could just call you and submit my complaint by leaving a voicemail message. That's my only point with, like, I think we need, if we're going to change it to be clear, we should be really clear. Do you mm-hmm. disagree?
Yep. No, I think perhaps a better word might be electronic record. I don't think typically people consider their telephone messages to be an electronic record. But if you send an MP3 of your complaint or a CD of your complaint or some other digital recording that expresses what the complaint is, that's the essence of this. This falls under the grievance procedures for the public, and we're discussing ways in which a complaint can be made. So I think it needs to be something that is a transferable record,
right,
in a way that I don't think a telephone message is.
So should we nullify that vote go back and revise?
You know what, if you want to, well, are we allowed to then immediately you know, move to amend a policy we just approved? All right.
There you go.
Reconsider.
Parliamentarian, I knew that was.
Fine. So there's.
Does it have to be a majority?
There's a second.
Majority reconsideration.
Okay. It has to be someone who voted majority.
Majority reconsideration, okay.
So I'm moving to reconsider.
Okay, fine. So there's been a motion to, made and seconded to reconsider. Okay. All those in favor of the motion to reconsider, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. So we're now reconsidering.
So,
I move that we amend policy number JKB on physical restraint and behavior support under section 10 grievance procedures, second paragraph, to read, the complaint must be submitted in writing or as an electronic recording to the Director of Student Services.
Second.
Okay. There's been a motion made and seconded. Any questions or concerns about that? Okay. All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. So now we're on the
policy as amended.
Yep. Policy's moved as amended.
Second.
Second. So any debate out now on the newly amended, reconsidered policy? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Thank you, Ms. Minnick, for your work on this and so many other policies.
Thank you.
Over time.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.
So next we have a vote on a job description, and this is for a special education teacher, and I'll turn the floor over to Dr. Provost to describe that.
Yes. So this is an updated job description for a special education teacher. The key changes that I'd like to direct your attention to on the second page are under additional considerations, where we explicitly talk about restraint training, and in physical requirements, where we explicitly talk about providing restraints. That, as has been pointed out, we've had a restraint policy for quite a while, but haven't actually had a job description that includes the ability to restrain. So this just clarifies that special education teachers who have been trained to perform restraints should perform restraints according to their job expectations.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the new job description for the special education teacher.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion about this? Okay. Hearing none.
I had a question.
Oh, sure.
Sorry. I forgot to email. I have questions about just a few typographical changes is that something that I can do later?
I could see the torch being passed slowly across.
So that have to be changed now. It will change nothing as far as the meaning of this. It's all hyphens. I want to add about 6 hyphens and I'll be perfectly satisfied. Do we have to do that now or can I just get it to the clerk later?
I think why don't you just express them now? I mean,
okay.
I just
I think it's 6. Of course, I didn't mark it up on my pager.
Is it a recurring like search and replace, or is it something you could just okay? Oh, go ahead, proceed.
We've got all night, right?
Yes.
Under essential functions, where it says participative.
We're still safe for a little longer here.
But I think building should have a hyphen after it too. Anyone want to chime in, Howard? Yeah, because otherwise it sounds like participative building. And content-based. Do you know what I'm saying? It should be building-based and content-based. It should be
building. Oh, it's a
right.
building
See,
based.
It's not understandable without the hyphen. Yeah. See? No.
So building hyphen and hyphen content. Hyphen.
Right.
Building-based.
It's building-based and content-based. So it would be building hyphen and content hyphen based.
So maybe it should be building hyphen based and content hyphen based.
And then it would be under note taking, I think, should be hyphenated under skills and ability, frequent and ongoing note taking. I actually did double check this with the dictionary. And then under daily flexibility and quick thinking skills, quick thinking when used as an adjective is hyphenated, quick thinking as a noun is not. So this one should be hyphenated. Sorry. There was one more. I don't know where it is.
Well,
Howard has
on the very last line, I say in hearing at, comma, or correctable with accommodation to not at or correctable. There should be a comma after at.
I like that. Mm-hmm.
So do we have all the hyphens?
Well, it takes sharp eyesight to be able to see these.
And
that's where the tie-in is. Or correctable.
Make a motion to accept?
Well, I think she's made a motion and she's sort of
working her way through it.
She's okay. Reading it out to us.
So you find time to get a drink of water.
I'm sorry.
It's all right with me.
You should just be Scrivener's errors. Just make them.
Edits. Oh, the time management. Time management. Hyphenated. I can't remember what the sixth was.
Give it up.
In the last second, the last second question.
Is it?
I'm managing.
That's what I'm asking.
Trained her well, Obi-Wan.
Then it would be and time management, so they're both. I don't think they're high.
In traditional English, the answer is yes, because it is a compound phrase that is a term in itself. In modern English, this doesn't always happen. I'm going to let you off the side.
That's what we do. We act as a committee.
All right, I can't remember what the other one was, but I'm fine.
Okay.
Nobody else cares.
We can catch it the next time. So all those hyphens plus Mr. Moore's comma, are those offered as an amendment?
Yes.
Okay. Made and seconded by Ms. Fallon and seconded by Mr. Moore. So is the committee, so all those in favor of accepting these amendments, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, those amendments are accepted. And now on the main motion of approving the special education teacher job description, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the next item on the agenda is the acceptance of a gift to the NHS PTO of $8,363 in fall grants, and I'll turn this over to Ms. Walczak. And we have a series of these gifts coming.
Yes, this is something that the PTO does each year for the high school. You've got an itemized list of what the grants are. Some of these are what we're calling in kind. The PTO will actually be making the payments for those. And then there's three that are itemized that they will actually submit the funds to us, and we will process these through our normal warrant process. So you've got the details on each of the grants each of the gifts that make up that total of $8,000.
Excellent.
Move to accept the NHS PTO grant.
Second.
You have a question, Ms. Fallon?
The numbers don't match. Does that matter?
The totals?
Yeah. They're not that far off. I just didn't know if it mattered. There's a very specific 8,363 on the donation, and then there's estimates, I guess, on the second page. Do you need them to match?
This is what got turned into us, so maybe you can just say in the motion approximately 8,363 to cover it.
Okay.
Sorry, I just noticed it.
I think it's the actual thing. Is they're giving the $8,363, and this is just roughly because
the approximate.
Right,
but I'm saying, does that matter that the numbers aren't reconciled?
I think as long as we're accepting the sum gift and then it'll be distributed internally, I'm comfortable with that.
Okay, if you're comfortable with that, okay. I'm fine.
So there's been a motion made and I believe seconded to accept this gift. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, that gift is gratefully accepted from the NHS PTO. Next, we have a gift from the NHS Swimming and Diving Booster Club, $455.93. Ms. Walczyk.
Yes, and under your new policy, this actually did not need to come to you since it's under $1,000, but we're still getting used to the new policy, so we didn't catch that. So we apologize for having one more item here, but it's basically a gift from the Swimming and Diving Booster Club to support the cost of our programs.
Move to accept the gift, even though it's not necessary because the superintendent could do it.
Second.
Okay. Any questions about this one? Ms. Fallon.
So I understand that under our new policy, we wouldn't have to accept this gift, but I also thought we were discussing having individual boosters. Wasn't that an issue at one point?
The boosters in general are working with NABC to talk about consolidating into NABC.
Okay.
It has not happened.
Okay.
But I think some of the booster clubs are preparing that way and are making donations to bring down their account balances.
Okay.
Nice. Okay. So has there been a motion made and seconded? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstention? Okay, so that gift is accepted. Next is a gift of the estate of Hannah Hopp. It is $2,092.32 to Northampton Public Schools.
Yes, Mrs. Hannah Hopp and her husband Gerald were residents of Northampton. They were generally very private individuals, but they had a way of supporting a number of causes in the community. And one of the things that was done was that her estate donated monies to various organizations around the city, and one was a donation you see in the amount of $4,000 and change to the city. So the city council divided that and directed money to some of the causes and organizations that had been of interest to them. So the city council has allocated $2,092.32 to the school department, and what we are doing, we'll be distributing that between the four elementary schools to buy library books, which if you look at the other interest they've got, libraries were something that was of interest to the family. So the four elementary schools will be adding collections.
Motion to accept the gift with gratitude.
Second. Okay. Any further discussion about this?
I can make a comment just because the evening's not gone long enough. I'm just really struck as I look at the itemization of the gifts that we have accepted tonight, overall, all the gifts, starting from the NEF gifts, and you look at each one of those individual projects and how just really exciting they are in terms of being interesting and engaging and really, you know, all sorts of different things that I would not have thought of that other people have thought of. They've just been really great and keep on going. If you look at like the NHS PTO itemization, you know, really interesting stuff that's being funded by the PTO and lots of it, engaging lots and lots of our students in all sorts of things beyond, you know, the workaday world of going to school. And then ending here with this really generous gift from people who, you know, were obviously far removed from, you know, the daily life of city business, but who obviously appreciated what the city does for them. And I just think that's, it's all just very striking to me how really wonderful all this is.
Okay, so Laura, we're all set with the vote on that? Okay, fine. So, okay, all those in favor then of accepting the Hannah Hopp gift, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any exemptions? Okay, it passes. The next item on the agenda is the vote to amend the circuit breaker budget. And I'll turn this over again to the business administrator.
Yes, when you voted the FY16 budget, one of the pieces that was in there was the circuit breaker budget, and you voted to put all of those money towards special ed tuitions. The way the circuit breaker law works is the money that we took in last year has to be used by the end of this year or it reverts to the general fund of the city. So we're asking you to approve a change to the circuit breaker budget for this year so we can use the additional revenues that we received in June of $8,882.
I'd like to make a motion to amend the circuit breaker budget to reflect the entire amount stated.
Second.
Okay. Any questions or discussion about this? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, it carries. Next, we have a vote on procedure for determination of legitimate public purpose. And I eagerly await this, Mr. Superintendent.
So,
which has raised many puzzled looks upon the members of the school committee tonight. I just have to say this. I mean, we're joking, but I think the public should know that I've worked with many school committees, and this committee by far and away is scrupulous about avoiding any type of conflict of interest. And the reason that we need a procedure now is because I'm going to recommend that you do something that I've never seen any other school committee do, but it's been in part based on good questions that committee members have asked and good research that has been done around the subject of field trips. Because it is typical whenever a class goes on a field trip that if there is a cost for the bus or if there is a cost for admission to whatever the event is, that the teacher who's supervising the students and chaperones as well, who are typically parents who are with the teacher, don't pay either for the transportation or for the admittance. And so one of the committee members asked, might that not put a public employee in potential violation of ethics rules of accepting a gift of greater than $50 value? And so in researching the question on the state ethics page, there actually is an opinion about this saying that it does raise a question. There is a procedure for addressing it. The proper procedure is that the employee should make a disclosure to the appointing body, which in this case for teachers would be the school committee, saying that they're intending to be on a field trip, and as part of the field trip they will not be paying for transportation or for admittance, and that's valued at greater than $50. And there's actually a form for that. Last month I shared some of the forms that teachers have begun to submit with field trips, and I've asked them to submit with field trips as a basis of the research we've done. But there's also another form that goes with that, which is the public body's determination that the travel satisfies a legitimate public purpose. My goal, I hope you know, even though it's almost 10 o'clock now, is to try to make the meetings as efficient as possible. And my thought is that it's not necessary for the committee to sign off on all of the determinations that the trips serve a public purpose, because when you vote to approve the field trip, you're in essence saying that the trip is a legitimate trip and it serves the needs of our kids. So my recommendation to you would be to delegate to the superintendent the authority to sign off on the determination form for teachers who are filing submittals, or any employee who's filing a submittal on the basis of field trip or other travel they'll be taking for a approved trip.
Okay. So any questions about the approach as described by the superintendent? Ms. Minnick.
Yeah, I'm confused. So if we say that a field trip is a legitimate public thing and that we should be paying for, do they still have to file a form with you?
Yes.
All right, I'm just going to go on record here saying this is just a colossal waste of paper. I'm sorry. Just what we need to do is have people have to fill out more paperwork just to do something good. Sorry, that was just a kind of a editorial comment.
Yeah.
Mr. Moore?
I agree, but I think that it's not going to be that much more work. They're filling out the field trip request. And so as long as those two pieces of paper are right next to each other, it will be a quick thing to fill out the second part of it. I'm a little bit I've always been confused. This is one of those questions I don't know, is there are a number of trips, particularly around athletics, that aren't field trips, and yet we continually approve athletics field trips. What is the difference between a trip that the track?
I think it's students leaving the state.
Some of these are in state.
Yeah, not the state.
If,
And I was just wondering what's the distinction there, and then, because then it will fall back onto, there will be this other piece of paperwork that you don't have to do for some and do have to do.
Well, I don't think that the disclosure form is involved with the athletic trips, because the coaches wouldn't be receiving a benefit of $50
or more. Requires some
They're there with their athletes. Right. I don't think anyone has ever conceived of charging coaches admission to the event with their families.
Since they're not paid really well.
No. So with respect to the travel to in-state athletic events, there is something in the policy. It escapes me right at the moment, but I know it has to do with the transportation of students policy.
And so some are and some aren't.
It must be a radius or some kind of a mile radius.
I think athletics.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
I just want to say, I know it does seem a little bit ridiculous, but when you're talking about like a trip to Cambodia, I think that's somehow like people do, like they do need to acknowledge, like in this $3,500 trip, I am in fact taking right. for free. And I think that it's absolutely warranted, and yeah. I'm so thrilled that the teachers do it, but I think that it's important that they be protected.
Yes.
And so I think it takes, 3 minutes to fill out the form?
Less.
But I think that, yeah, for $50, like, I'm going to the museum with my class, it seems absurd, but for some of the bigger trips, it seems like you can understand where the rule mm-hmm. came from.
Absolutely.
Ms. Hannah had her hand up, and then come back here.
So when a field trip gets approved, let's say we approve $500 for a field trip, does the money, who pays for the tickets and admission ahead of time? Do, you know, we approve the $500, do we give the $500 to the teacher to pay that? So how does that work?
Trips are different. A lot of the trips that are going on are actually funded by the PTO. So in most cases, they're paying the cost of the bus and the cost of admission. There's some cases where the PTO or other groups will turn the money over to us, and we do a purchase order. We can't legally pay in advance for anything, so we would do a purchase order and make a payment after.
So who fronts the money?
If the school department is paying for it, whether it's through a cash donation to us or our budget, we can't prepay. They have to take a purchase order.
But what if where they're going doesn't accept a purchase order? Is it the teachers that are?
We've tried to avoid that. There was more of that going on before I got here. Uh-huh. We tried to reduce that down. I only know of one case that happened last year, uh-huh. and it's a field trip that we've actually discussed not allowing in the future uh-huh. for other reasons.
Oh, okay.
So hopefully most places will take a purchase order.
Okay. Great.
But a lot of our trips are funded by the PTOs also, so they can handle it however they wish to handle it.
Right. So they might cash to the teacher to pay for that.
Yes.
Okay, that makes sense.
Or a check.
That's good for it.
Did you have a?
I think she did first.
Okay, sorry, Ms. Hennessy.
I want to say that if the public is listening at this point, that accepting $3,000 on a trip to Cambodia or whatever, they're on their vacation with high school students all the time, and
there's no net benefit.
There's no benefit.
Yeah.
So I just want to make sure people know that they're not like hanging out in Cancun not taking care of their kids.
I just wanted to say that with the chaperones, and I understand we need chaperones and everything else. I'm just wondering, is it the same chaperones each year? Is there an opportunity for other chaperones to take advantage of these gifts, so to speak? Or is it just the same people that first say, yes, I get to go, and then it goes by then, and then who picks that criteria, or do you not know? So theoretically, then it could be, even though it's not a vacation, so it could be a vacation if somebody picked it the same year. They used it as a vacation, as opposed to letting other chaperones or whatnot ever go.
As long as you consider a vacation taking care of 15 high schoolers.
Yeah. Right.
If it's your passionate love, it's a vacation. No.
Okay. Mr. Sahowski, did you have
a comment? The point was already made. On the thank you.
Okay. Okay, so. Yeah, we do need a motion to accept this procedure.
To accept the procedure. For the determination of legitimate public purpose.
Second.
Okay. And third. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that procedure is now official. Next, we have a vote on a decision regarding our choice going forward of either MCAS or PARC. And I will turn this over to Dr. Provost.
Thank you. And I would ask the committee to let me know if I'm too long-winded here, but committee members have received some questions from the public and have asked me to talk a little bit, not only about my recommendation for testing, but the actual requirement for testing. So I'll say something about that. I know that some of you may have received some emails concerning the federal requirement for testing. And that email, which I think is, for the most part, accurate, is in some cases not very responsive to the Massachusetts situation, because Massachusetts had a testing regime in place long before No Child Left Behind or the federal testing requirement. In fact, in many ways, the federal requirement was modeled after Massachusetts. So the testing regime really in Massachusetts began as a part of the Education Reform Act of 1993. It was part of what was at the time called a grand bargain. The grand bargain was that we were going to move away from funding schools solely on local property taxes and have a much more involvement at the statewide level of trying to equalize financing between districts. The concern was that many of the more affluent communities were going to be distributing their wealth to less affluent communities through state income tax and the Chapter 70 formula. And people thought, well, those poorer communities won't spend the money well. We need to have some measures in place to make sure that the money goes to the appropriate services that benefit students. And the legislation was stuck. Remember, this was legislation that was done in response to a lawsuit saying that the Massachusetts system of funding public education was unconstitutional. So the sort of the testing regime came through as the compromise that was able to break the logjam. The idea was that we would authorize this progressive redistribution of wealth with the understanding that there would be an accountability system across the board as a way of measuring whether sharing wealth from richer communities to poorer communities was having any kind of an impact. That's where Massachusetts got involved in the testing situation. The people have been, members have been asked about opt-out. In part, they've been asked an opt-out because I've asked parents and educators to weigh in on the choice we have in front of us tonight as to whether to implement MCAS for another year or to go with PARC. Some parents have said, why not do neither? Let's just opt out. So this question was addressed last year, or 2 years ago at this point, by both the Commissioner of Education and the General Counsel for the state of Massachusetts. The Commissioner wrote that there is no opt-out option from the landmark legislation. In short, participation in the statewide assessment program is mandatory. People have asked, well, what is the potential penalty to the district in terms of finances? There is no specific financial penalty assigned to districts because participation is required. It's assured. The General Counsel for Massachusetts reiterated this point in a letter to the Worcester Public Schools, who were considering opt-out options, and pointed out that there are lots of statutes that govern education in Massachusetts that do allow an opt-out option for parents. And whenever there is an opt-out, either for districts or for parents, the legislation clearly explains what the procedure is to opt out. But ed reform, the 1993 law in Massachusetts, has no provision because the expectation is that participation is mandatory. So When people ask what could the penalties be, I really see two potential areas where the committee should be aware when they're talking to the public about opting out. One is that were the district not to participate, I think that we would be subject to a number of civil rights claims under Title VI of the Civil Rights Act, the Equal Educational Opportunities Act, Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act. All of these laws require that the district provide equal access to protected classes to the full range of educational opportunities within the district and state. That full range includes participation in the assessment system. In fact, one of the civil rights criteria that the district has to demonstrate every year, and just did last year as part of its civil rights audit, is that it allows all students to participate in testing on an equal basis without bias to any sort of protected class. So I think there would be a civil rights violation for any protected classes if we did not participate in testing. I know that may sound kind of bizarre to some, because people have raised civil rights questions about whether this test itself has civil rights issues. But right now, the law of the land is that you have to provide access to students to the testing system as a part of their right to equal access. The other potential consequence for the district would be the impact on accountability ratings. So, you know, last year, Northampton High School went from a level one school to a level two school. That was based not at all on performance. It was based solely on participation. In fact, it was based on participation of one subgroup on one test. It was because one child, as a matter of fact, didn't participate in a test, that Northampton went from level one to level two. And as we found out this morning, there's a nearby district where participation was even less, and they were dropped to level three, which I think is particularly important, because level one, two, and three status are the only statuses that are based upon any kind of a mathematical formula. The descent from level three to level four is basically a determination at the commissioner and board level that you're just not getting better fast enough. So once you're in level three, you're potentially on the block for level four. So I think it's concerning to potentially put the district in a place where it would be in an accountability status one level above level four, just due to participation. Level three is, we are a level three district already, and we have at this point one school that's still in level three status, and the loss of autonomy that entails is huge. So the act of not participating, which is in one sense is for some people considered an act of civil disobedience to enhance the rights of students and families, actually has the opposite effect of bringing the schools involved into under the requirements of the turnaround plan and everything else that has to be done once you're determined to be level three. So I would strongly advocate for placing the option of doing neither testing off the table. So now my recommendation. I recommend that we participate in MCAS again for 2016. I have four reasons for my recommendation. The first is I think MCAS is better aligned with community values. Not saying perfectly aligned, but better aligned. I say it on the basis of the feedback we've gotten from educators and from parents in the survey that was deployed. It wasn't a huge response, but we had about 80 people who responded. Among educators, MCAS was the preference by a 3-to-1 ratio. Among parents, MCAS was the preference by 2.5-to-1 ratio. Among the administrative team, leadership team, it was the unanimous choice. Second reason that I would like to recommend we continue to participate in MCAS as opposed to change to PARC is I think it'll allow us to better implement DDMs. This is our second year of DDM implementation. It's the first year, I think, that teachers are really understanding the full concept of DDM and trying to incorporate that into their thinking about assessment, their own assessments.
I just wanted to give the full name of that.
Sure,
that's acronym, just for those who don't know the jargon at all.
Sure, those are the district of term measures, which are the growth measures that are used as one component of the evaluation system to show how much growth students gain under the direction of a teacher. So for many of the teachers in our district, they're mandated to use MCAS as one of their DDMs. They've just gone through the first cycle of using MCAS as a DDM, and I think are beginning to come to terms with that. I think changing from MCAS to PARC for those teachers midstream is really unfair. They're really doing their level best to try to implement the expectations for district determined measures in a good way that makes sense not only for them but for kids. And I think if we change the test on them, that will just set back our progress with that. The third reason that I'd recommend continuing with MCAS is if we need to change all of the IEPs written in grades 3 through 8 between now and the time the testing window opens in the spring, that will be a nightmare. The testing accommodations that are allowed under PARC are different than the testing accommodations that are allowed under MCAS, so we'd be in the position of revising IEPs for any students who have been found to be eligible for testing accommodations from the ones that are allowed under MCAS to the ones that are allowed under PARC. And the fourth reason I'd like to recommend MCAS is I think it will provide greater consistency for students. We know PARC is going away after this year. If we vote to change to PARC now, we'll be guaranteeing that students have 3 consecutive years of a different test. It would have been PARC, it would have been MCAS 1.0 last year, then PARC this year, then MCAS 2.0 next year. I just think 3 consecutive years under 3 testing regimes is not in the best interest of students. So for all those reasons, my recommendation would be that we maintain our current testing choice and stay with MCAS for this spring.
Okay. Certainly.
All right. I mean, just to discuss both options. I know that MCAS has associated with it the John and Abigail Adams Scholarship. Will PARC have something comparable to that, or does it? I mean, just when we're thinking about it.
So that doesn't actually, wouldn't be impacted by the choice because the PARC assessment is only for grades 3 through 8 at this time. The John and Abigail Adams is based on the 10th grade MCAS and the science test in the high school. And those tests are not changing. Even under the old system where it was thought that we would go to PARC, those were going to be, the 10th grade assessments were going to remain as MCAS for a number of years while students were prepared to take MCAS as their competency determination test.
So then what you're talking about is possibly taking 2 tests so that kids, like, let's pick an 8th grader since that's 2 years away from the MCAS and the opportunity to get the scholarship. Trying to figure out how to word the question. So in 2 years, the kid takes PARC in 8th grade. In 2 years, they're going to take the MCAS, and it's going to be a different test in order to get the scholarship. Is that what you're saying?
It wouldn't be in order to get the scholarship. It would be because the 10th grade test is the test that has the competency determination attached to it. It's the high-stakes test. And the thought is that before you can change graduation requirements for all the students in the state, there needs to be more opportunity to prepare them to be able to meet the competency determination requirement. So The testing in grades 9 and 10 would not change even under the park system. So what I'm saying is, if we were a park district, students would take park in 8th grade, but they would still take MCAS in 10th grade.
So just, you know, what would be the advantage, if any? I mean, let's just devil's advocate it out. Let's say, let's do the park. What would be the advantage of doing a park? Because I just don't see it.
So the only two potential advantages of doing park that really sort of resonate with me is that there is a hold harmless option under park, which means that if a school chooses to change from MCAS and go to park, and student performance is worse under park than under MCAS, the accountability rating cannot be reduced. It can only be increased if the performance is better under park. There are questions about the hold harmless, though, because the overall accountability rating, including the accountability ratings that were just released for our schools yesterday, are based on a four-year rolling average. And some of the communications we have indicated, that we've gotten recently, have indicated that even if the district is held harmless from the immediate reduction in its accountability rating based on the hold harmless provision with park, the scores still count towards the four-year rolling average for the accountability determination later on. So
that's a negative, though, right?
No, it's
that's a positive.
It's a positive that we know that accountability ratings couldn't go down next year.
Okay, but overall, in the 4 years scheme of it, that's
but in, right. There may be that hold harmless may not be a truly hold harmless. It may be sort of like a hold, you know. I don't know, temporarily harmless.
So we're sticking with MCAS, and is there any way, like, I think part of the problem that we have with any of them, I mean, we as the people that I'm getting from, is the high-stakes nature of the test also. Is there any way that, you know, through our legislators, or can we vote to not, you know, like, oh, well, heck with that requirement. I mean, we'll take care of it, we'll do the test and everything else, but, you know, that's the problem that I have really have with it, is the fact that, you know, so much matters on a test when not everybody can take that well.
So, you know, there is legislation pending now for a testing moratorium. You know, I don't know how successful that legislation might be, but that would be, in my mind, a legitimate potential way of voicing a concern about testing. It's a way of doing it that doesn't cause the school committee to violate civil rights of kids. It would be a way of doing it that doesn't violate state law, okay, which is always good. I think that, you know, the question about, you know, the high stakes nature of it is something that's you know, less likely to go away. You know, the high stakes attaches at 10th grade. It doesn't attach at any other grade. I think there is an interest that the Department of Education has on wanting to make sure that a diploma equals a diploma equals a diploma. You know, there was a time, I remember, in the pre-MCAS era when kids with very little skill would walk out of high school with a diploma. And it did cast some clouds upon the value of the credential. And I do think that piece will probably be there in some form or another. I don't know if it'll be MCAS. I don't know if it'll be 10th grade. I don't know if it will be based on some other objective form of assessment. But I think that's probably likely to be around, not for all grades, but for the final determination of a diploma.
Okay, and then the other question I have right now is the today with the Every Student Succeeds Act going through and saying, okay, never mind on No Child Left Behind, let's go another direction. Does that, I know it affects us, but I mean on a day-to-day basis, does that affect us? I mean, is there something that's changed today as opposed to yesterday other than this philosophical change?
So I'd go back to my original comments and say in Massachusetts, the testing system we're living under wasn't brought to us by the federal government, it was brought to us by state government. That has not changed.
But do you see that? Do you see ESSA as changing anything? I guess is the question.
I think it will change some things. I think it is going to take us a while. We're talking about legislation that's still awaiting the president's signature. We'll know better when the statute is reduced to regulations. Okay. So I think it's a little early to tell. I do think in general it's a positive step. I mean, certainly just getting anything reauthorized is a positive step. I think at this point the law is something like 7 years overdue for reauthorization, and the education landscape has changed a lot in the time it's been awaiting reauthorization. So I think that's positive. But to the question we have before us, which is MCAS or PARC, that's not a question that's coming to us from the federal government. It's a question that's coming to us from our own Department of Education.
Okay.
Ms. Hennessy, you had a question?
Yeah, just more of a comment. Like, I understand the choice and between PARC and MCAS, and I agree. I agree because MCAS is actually an untimed test, whereas PARC mm-hmm. is different. But I find, I had talked to Dr. Provost earlier about hopefully next meeting, I know some of us won't be here, but of us signing on as Northampton School Committee supporting a 3-year moratorium on the high stakes testing, because while I agree that there was a meaninglessness to some high school diplomas, I understand that, and I, as a special education teacher, I know that there is a focus and a greater richness in the curriculum available to more students, and yet I think it's really the high stakes nature harms so many students, and particularly special needs students. And I think that the way the state has organized this right now, with the PARC and with the connection with the commissioner to PARC and this kind of new MCAS point, whatever, I think it's warranted to call for a moratorium. And I would like us to vote on it next time. I know we can't because it's not on the agenda, but it is something I would like on the agenda next time. That's all.
Mr. Moore.
Likewise, a comment. I think a lot of, you know, the summary of the tests and the relative merits of them, so I really just point out sort of, I don't know, it's kind of like a weird sort of self-referential, I don't know, almost Alice in Wonderland kind of quality to the decisions made about the tests. You know, when things like when you can go from one level to another because of a relatively small, you know, statistical detail, which I understand their reasons. They don't want people like having their not so good testers not taking the test. But when it's such a huge consequence occurs there, it's kind of like, huh? And then when it turns out that the accommodations for the test are different for the test, you know, what's permissible as an accommodation, it's like, well, so what was the principled reason for either of those lists of accommodations? You know? Or are they just, once again, like a self-referential kind of, well, because we said so, kind of list of accommodations. And likewise, you know, when the scoring of what is deemed proficient, that number is set after the test has been taken, you know, and scored, that's a little question about, oh, so what are these questions that are being asked that we are so sure our kids need to have the answers to, but we can't tell you until after we've gotten the results back as to what was a passing score. You know, in other words, there's a lot of sort of, I don't know, questions about how principled all of this is. And so then here we are with this lovely Hobson's choice, you know, take any horse as long as it's the one next to the door. and that's what we've got here, you know, take any test as long as it's the one with high stakes attached to it. And I think you mentioned the high stakes don't attach to high school in terms of, yeah, in terms of graduating, but they're very high stakes for the grade school tests in terms of the level of the school. And in many ways, that's a more pernicious kind of a high stake because it puts the children's performance on the test is then responsible for what happens to their school and to their teachers. And so that's, you know, I suppose, I think that may be even more kind of like, oh, really? Is that how we want to run this railroad? All in all, I don't like the choices we have to make, but clearly I think we should do the, you know, the MCAS again because, well, it's the one closest to the door.
Mr. Ball, and then Ms. Hannah.
Okay, so my question, back to what I was talking about, is the constituents who write us and ask us to, you know, do things that we're not able to do, the ability to change that would be at the legislative level, wouldn't it? So that basically then we can implore all of you people out there to write your legislators for decisions that we can't. So I like to have an answer, you know, not just, it's not our job, but, you know, here's an answer. So the answer would be write the legislators and work that way, because we cannot do something illegal here. So, because we got a lot of letters. Thank you.
Ms. Hannah.
So I'm thinking something that Lisa said earlier about that what ultimately our responsibility is to do is to kind of follow our own moral compass in terms of the decisions that we make, regardless of what our constituencies reach out and give us their opinions on. And I, for myself, can't choose either of these tests because I think they're deplorable. I think shame on the state government for bullying us with level 1, 2, and 3 and shaming us into what I think is causing harm to all children. I think that it's ironic that we could face a civil rights claim because it's really clear that there, to me, in my opinion, that there are civil rights violations in having to take the test, because we know that you can base a child's performance based on their socioeconomic status. So it's a classist environment that we're dealing with. And you know, I would totally support us signing on to a moratorium. And I would just really encourage us to really consider the well-being of the young people with whom we're responsible. It's not just, I mean, I support the opt-out movement, but you know, you can opt out of the tests, but you know, you go into the classrooms and the worksheets that the teachers are being provided from Pearson are preparing students for the test. So you can choose to opt your child out of the test, but the teachers are still feeling the pressure to teach for the test. And I think that, I just think it's, you know, 2 years ago we sat here and everybody said, well, yeah, we should stick with MCAS, but you know, PARC's coming, PARC's coming, PARC's coming, PARC's coming, and now PARC's off the table. So I think we should hold our sights much higher than just sort of settling for what we just anticipate coming and take a progressive step forward and say no to the high stakes test. That's my opinion. Okay.
Any other questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to how do we want to word this? I'd like MCAS is what I want, is to have MCAS be the test that we take as a district, we continue to take, especially for the third to eighth grade. Is that okay?
Okay. So there's been a motion made to continue with MCAS. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any other discussion? Ms. Duvall.
I just want to say that while personally I may have different feelings than how I'm going to vote, I have to vote for MCAS just because as a school committee member, it's within the legality. If I have a problem with it, I will be writing the legislator, which I do have a problem with, by the way, I will be writing the legislator. But as far as today goes, my decision to vote for the MCAS comes from having to make a decision for our schools. It doesn't have to come as a philosophical discussion or a decision that I'm making. And I just want to make that really clear to the people out there and everyone that I don't believe in the high stakes testing. However, we need to function and as a school district, and we need to give the superintendent and the administrator a direction. And the direction that I'm choosing to give is MCAS as a choice of MCAS or PARC. However, I do feel that both need to be changed.
Okay. Any other comments or discussions? Hearing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Ms. Hannah and Ms. Hennessy abstain. Okay, so the motion carries. So now we move on to a report from Ms. Walczyk, and this is a report on an audit of the student activity accounts.
Yes, I'm just going to give you an overview and then we'll tackle questions if you have them. But we gave you copies of the audits of the high school student activity account and the JFK student activity account from last through June of 14. At the suggestion of the auditors, they came back this past fall to look at last year, June of 15, and actually did an audit of the high, mini audit, I called it, of the high school through August 30th of 15 to look at where we stand. If you went through the audits, there were a number of findings. I gave you a summary chart listing the findings and which building they found them in. Not each one was in every building, but most of them were common to the two buildings. A lot of this, I think, came about because past audits appeared to not have been shared with the principals and the student activity bookkeepers to begin working on this. At the same time, the regulations from the state were changing and tightening up on a lot of the controls. These student activity accounts are where all the fundraising monies that the kids raise are maintained. We're basically trustees of student monies. The laws changed a year or two ago to tighten up on a lot of the regulations, and that wasn't relayed to everybody in district. As I got here last year and began to see some of this that was going on, we've been working on it. The audit has confirmed that we have a long way to go. And in the cover report that I gave you attached to this, I detailed each of the findings and where we are in terms of making progress towards addressing each of those issues.
Ms. Fallon, go ahead.
It wasn't clear to me, who are the student activity bookkeepers? Is that their designated job, or is it
It's a stipend to someone in the district. The jobs are periodically posted, and there's an employee at the high school who does it, and actually past employee at the middle school who's done it for years, who's still continuing to do it at the middle school.
Okay, so it's not the turnover that's the problem. Once we train them, we should be.
Well, they can turn over. They're appointed positions. They can quit at any point. There was some turnover a couple of years ago at the high school. I think the middle school has had a little more continuity than the high school. Yes, they're compensated. There's stipends that are outlined in your Unit A contract. They don't necessarily go to teachers, but they're listed in the Unit A contract and they're posted and the principals appoint somebody to that position.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Hennessy.
I saw a student treasurer has to sign.
Yes, a student officer.
Officer. I was curious about an officer of a class. Here's my question. If classes raise money, I assume,
yes.
At the high school level.
Yeah, yes.
What happens to that account now when the class graduates?
The two issues play into it. The law allows us only to maintain student funds.
Yep.
So once the students graduate, we have no legal authority to maintain those funds. The school committee policy addresses some steps on what happens to what we call graduated class funds.
Yep.
So there's, and I don't have all the Northampton process memorized, but it's typically the students can transfer the funds to their class officers and take them with them to hold them for their 5-year reunion, but they must hold them, we can't.
Okay.
They could choose to donate it to the next senior class.
It has not changed in the law in the past?
No, okay. No. Once they graduate, we can only maintain them for a short window of time to pay any outstanding bills.
Thank you.
Yes.
I'm sorry, this one's quick too. When you say monies that we should not be collecting, and one of the things was transfer fees, and you said that you stopped collecting, did you mean that student activities account has stopped collecting them, or has the district stopped collecting transcript fees?
My understanding, the high school has stopped collecting them, because if we do collect them, they just revert to the general fund of the city, so the high school didn't feel there was any point in charging the kids if they couldn't use the funds of the high school to do some of the programs they'd been doing.
Everyone looks at me like.
Well, yeah.
I didn't create municipal finance.
The general rule is, if there's not a law that we get to keep the money, the general fund gets the money.
Yes. Something about Caesar or something.
It's kind of by default. If there's no law, they get.
It's a law, not a policy. Right, it's a law that comes.
In terms of where the money goes.
In terms of
state laws and regulations. And I can't quote the exact one, but unless there's a specific law that allows a department of the city to retain the funds, then any funds collected on behalf of the city go to the general fund. So we have funds, we have laws authorized in revolving accounts, athletic accounts, gift accounts, but there's no account for library late fees or transcript fees.
Okay, so let's go to library fees. What happens to those when the kids pay the library fees? They don't go to the school, they go to the city?
Right now, both schools have stopped collecting late fees. Lost book fees the schools can collect. There's a law that allows us to maintain lost textbook or library book fees. So if a student loses a book, they can be charged for it. We can hold on to that money to basically buy a new book to replace it. There's no law authorizing us to retain any monies that we charge for a student turning their book in late.
Ms. Fallon.
I'm sorry, I'm really dragging this out.
Not at all.
When you talk about replenishing the checking account from the savings account to bring it up to the levels, whether it's 25,000, but then you've got breakdowns of individual groups, like the Spanish club, the French, whatever. Is that getting dispersed? Who's in charge of dispersing it to each? If they're not fundraising, I'm not sure I understand. If you're not fundraising and that student activity money is coming from the savings into the checking, then how is it getting divided up?
If the easiest correlation I can make is the checking account's like a petty cash. So all the money that is taken in is deposited to the agency account or the savings account. The school committee policy allowed each checking account to have money. You can consider that a petty cash out of that savings account. So the bills are paid out of the checking account, the smaller bills, and periodically they turn in to be replenished to the checking account. But in the meantime, every transaction is being logged against the class or the club or the activity that's got the income and the expenses going out. It's almost, I don't want to call it double bookkeeping, but you're tracking how much is in your savings in your checking account, and you're tracking how much belongs to each of your clubs. And one of the main things auditors look at is do those balance. So if you've got 25 in the checking and 50 in the savings, you've got 75, do your class accounts equal 75,000? Because if they're 90, you've got a problem.
Right, but I'm saying what he recommended in his final recommendations was to transfer that money, to top it off so that it's at the maximum in the checking account.
Yes.
And I'm saying, does that money get dispersed then to the individual groups?
It doesn't affect the amount that belongs to the groups.
It doesn't.
Basically,
okay.
What happened is over 5 or 10 or 20 years, some of the checks that were paid out of the checking account, the petty cash account, never got turned in to be reimbursed back to the checking account, so the checking account balance has declined. It's merely a case of they left the money in the savings account instead of getting into the checking, but okay. The amount that each club has is still being maintained.
Okay.
So the total funds are balanced. He verified that again this week for me over the phone.
Okay.
Any other questions regarding
the
report?
I have a question. On number where it says 6, the inactive accounts at JFK, is it just one inactive account? Are there many?
I'm actually not sure if there's any at JFK.
There's no check.
Most of the ones that we have, so that means JFK had no inactive accounts.
Well, then let's go the other way then, for Northampton High School.
Yes, it's common at high schools to have inactive accounts, and we have to follow your policy, and I believe it's bring those to you at a future date to dissolve them, and there'll be a recommendation as to where to transfer those monies. Let's, I don't know what club to pick on. Let's say that there used to be a ballerina club. I don't know, I gotta pick a name. And that club no longer exists, but there's money in it, then the principal has to make a recommendation.
So let's say there's a dance club.
That money gets transferred.
Can the principal make the recommendation to say, okay, we no longer are ballerinas, but we do have a dance troupe over
yes.
here, and we can so there's leeway then that we can take the intent or the purpose of the money and slide it over to another group if it's an inactive account, or it doesn't necessarily have to revert back to the city?
This is nothing to do with the city. These are not taxpayer funds. These are student funds, and the principals are the trustees.
Okay.
So there's a whole different set of laws on these. So the inactive accounts will come to you at some point with recommendations on where to transfer those.
We never give them back to the kids. I mean, like, to say there's only 4 ballerinas. We don't say here's $100 extra.
That's up to the kids to choose. That's why the kids have to sign off. It's their money.
Got it.
They have to make a decision on what to do with it. So if they dissolve a club and they put the money in, they do have some options on taking it out.
Okay. And how come JFK doesn't have any stipends?
It's not that they don't have any, it's that they weren't paying any out of the account. They had no finding that they were paying some.
Got it. Okay, thank you.
Ms. Fallon.
I noticed at the high school there are a couple negative accounts. Is there a mechanism to prevent them from going too far into debt?
That's part of what we're working on.
Oh.
It's possible somebody could have a short-term deficit. They could be paying the bills for the car wash, buying the materials before they have the car wash, but you want to look at over a period of time, and there shouldn't be a constant deficit, so that's something that we're working on.
Okay.
Okay, so there's not really a vote. This is just a report that the business administrator has put together for us, so if there's no more questions, we can move on to the next item on the agenda. We have a vote, and this is for the release of executive session minutes.
Say we don't say anything.
And I don't actually
make a motion to set them, and then do you want to discuss it after that? Is that how we do it?
Sure.
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion to, I'd like to move to approve executive session minutes for release to the public.
Okay. So this is actually, I believe these are minutes that we've approved in executive session already.
So just to be open.
Tonight, we're just authorizing the release of them. And I believe it's a set of minutes from May 8th, June 12th, 2014, of the full school committee, December 4th, 2014, of the negotiating subcommittee, January 22nd, 2015, of the negotiating subcommittee. Let me just get to the, let's see.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, they're all listed. Sorry about that. Yeah. So as listed on the agenda. Sorry, I could have just done it that way. Yeah, so.
I stated in it that it was, it's all minutes. I said it executive meeting. Are these only executive meetings?
These are only executive session minutes that are being prepared. They're for release publicly. They've been approved. We're now releasing them to the public.
Okay, from the different, okay, I get it.
Exactly.
Never mind.
So so again, negotiating subcommittee of January 22nd, school committee meeting of January 29th, 2015, again, negotiating subcommittee meeting March 5th, 2015, and June 9th, 2015, school committee meeting June 11th, 2015, negotiating subcommittee July 13th and September 3rd. I believe there are just a very few redactions in cases that involve names that we are not at liberty to release. Otherwise, we're releasing these because the reason for the executive session no longer exists. So there's been a motion made. Is it seconded?
Sorry.
Okay. Any discussion on releasing these? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. So thank you, Mr. Zahowski. I appreciate that. We've already done N, unless anyone wants to do it again. Unless anyone wants to do it again, I think we'll pass and we'll continue on the agenda to the personnel report. Ms. Walczyk.
Yes, we've got a short one for the month of November. Basically, on new hires, we've got three staff members listed for you that were hired, as well as five coaches. And then on separations, we've got one staff member and two coaches. And no retirements, and a couple of transfers or parallel transfers, basically, within the school department.
Ms. Duvall, do you have a question?
I do. On the promotions transfers, we have Ms. Julie Spencer Robinson from sixth grade teacher at JFK to 1 year full-time release from teaching effective 11/9/15. For clarification, is she's starting, next year, September, is she going all the way till November, or does she start the new year? Because this is 1 year full time. So is it really 1 year from 11/9/11/9, or is it 11/9 till the beginning of the following school year starting?
So the agreement was for the current school year.
Right, so then.
It should say school year.
Okay, probably. Got it. Just clarifying, that was all.
Okay, any other questions about the personnel report? How about the business manager's report?
Also short, although I've got one item that wasn't on there, which is some gifts. So you've got the regular monthly appropriation report, and I've outlined the deficits. We are doing a lot of work this month on doing some budget transfers, as you saw earlier in the meeting, and then there are some smaller transfers that are happening so that by next month, the deficits that you actually see in the printout should look better. The one item that was not on there is we get used to your new gift policy, is we have a couple of gifts that came in. The policy asks for a report to the committee each month. So the gifts under $1,000 that were accepted by the principals this month were at Jackson Street School. There was a pizza and salad for the family dinners that was donated by the PTO. And at Ryan Road, there was a printer for the computer lab. Again, these are donations by the PTOs when the principals are accepting them. And then at the superintendent level, there were two gifts. To NHS, there was a gift from Professor Michael Gora of some Library of America books. There were multiple titles that he donated to the library at the high school. And at Leeds School, Nancy Dickinson donated a multimedia sculpture for display at the school.
Okay, that then moves us to the superintendent's report.
Thank you. Recent events in our schools and in the world have led me to spend a lot of time reflecting upon the way we use our words. If you spend any amount of time with young children or in classrooms for young children, you're sure to hear some adults say, use your words. But sitting next to a special educator, I think we may need to modify those instructions. Maybe we need to say something like, use your words to help your friends, or use your words to solve problems. Because when they're spoken rashly, or in anger, or with malice, words can be very hurtful, and they can cause all kinds of problems. Only words that are true and salutary will serve our purpose to enlighten minds and to move hearts. I just wanted to say to the community that we seek to affirm all students, and to respect their families, and to treat them with dignity. And all means all. If anyone doubts that, they need look no farther than the mural that adorns JFK, or the NHS Cares poster that has been signed off on by countless high school students and faculty this week. Every problem that affects our society has some impact within the schoolhouse doors. And we know that much of human behavior is motivated by the desire for attention. And as a society, I think we've just been paying way too much attention to people who say hateful things. Mm-hmm. Our work is to turn that dynamic on its head, to reinforce caring and considerate behavior, and to confront words that hurt. I'd like to thank the students and educators who've already signed the NHS Cares poster, because they're the ones who are really using their words to help their friends and to solve problems. And that's my report.
Excellent. Thank you, Mr. Superintendent. We now move to very important and special new business item, and that is that tonight is the last school committee meeting of the term, and it's also the last school committee meeting for four of our members. And so I wanted to, we do have some presentations that we want to make, and I want to just quickly go through, mention the individual members that were recognized, just give a quick synopsis of their service on the committee. And then I know, excellent. I'm searching for the electronic version. So, Ms. Duvall, Blue Duvall, elected on November 8th, 2011, sworn in on January 3rd, 2012, served 4 years as at-large member. You've served on Rules and Policy, the Conference Committee, as well as the Late Start Ad Hoc Subcommittee. You've been our legislative liaison, Northampton Prevention Coalition representative, and SPEDPAC liaison. Pam.
ZEDAC Ad Hoc Committee. I was on the Phys Ed Ad Hoc Committee, too.
Oh, Phys Ed Ad Hoc. Uh-huh. Sorry, that one.
And I'll do the principal searches. I was on two of the three principal searches.
Okay, excellent. Sorry we missed that.
That's okay.
Pam Hanna, elected on November 5th, 2013. Sworn in on January 6, 2014. You've served this 2-year term. You've been a member of the Rules and Policy Committee, the Conference Committee, the Northampton Prevention Coalition representative, and the Superintendent Screening Committee in 2014. She's not with us this evening, but the other at-large school committee member, Carrie Nykerchuk, also elected November 5th, 2013, and sworn in on January 6th, 2014. She served this full 2-year term. She served on the Curriculum Subcommittee. She was a member of the Negotiating Subcommittee, as well as the Superintendent Evaluation Team. And then our colleague from Ward 6, Lisa Minnick, who was appointed on December 13th, 1990 to the school committee. So for those of you doing the math, that's 25 years ago. Sworn in on December 19th, just 3 days later, 1990. served on budget property, this curriculum, and is obviously the current chair of the Rules and Policy Committee. She's been the vice chair of this body. She's been our representative to the Collaborative for Educational Services, and she's the chair of their board, the conference committee, the JFK Middle School Building Committee, the negotiating subcommittee, more than one superintendent search committee, the NHS Principal Search Committee, 96-97, the Personnel Advisory Committee, the Superintendent Evaluation Team, the Teacher Evaluation Labor Management Team, the Teacher Performance Standards and Teacher Evaluation Study Committee, the co-chair. She also was the recipient of the 2003 Mass Association of School Committees All-State School Committee Member. And then obviously earlier this year, she was awarded the Mass Association of School Committees Lifetime Achievement Award winner. So I just want to say what a pleasure it's been to serve with all four of you. And I know that I speak on behalf of the citizens of Northampton. We thank you for your service. And I'm going to turn it over to the vice chair to say a few words, and then we're going to have some presentations.
Ms. Duvall wanted me to also mention she was on the District Improvement Plan Committee.
That's the next 5 years, yes. I'm still here.
So let it be known. I just share a few remarks. It's getting late this evening. The same remarks that I shared a couple years ago to our departing members. A lot's been said about JFK Middle School this evening. Lisa Minnick was part of the building committee, and as we sit in the conference room, as we sit in the JFK Middle School, I can't help but think of President Kennedy and some of his most favorite, my most favorite quote, and one of his most famous quotes, and it's, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. I think when we think of a line like this, it helps remind us all why we got into public service to begin with. As an elected official, each one of us on a daily basis is reminded that the work that we do impacts the lives of nearly 3,000 young people in our district, as well as those who seek to educate them, our teachers, feed them, our cafeteria workers and staff, and support them, all those that help out in the classrooms and at home. Our personal values of honesty, fairness, respect, and compassion are tested as we do our very best to make the decisions that will benefit those who elected us, as well as their children. But balancing the needs of an entire district is difficult. Each one of us, at some point in time, most likely has made a mistake. We've heard this evening in some of the remarks made that it can be challenging. This is just an unavoidable consequence of constantly having to make tough decisions. These choices result in not being able to please everyone, and this can make any person uncomfortable. For we're all connected to the people that we serve. They are our family members, they are our friends, they're our neighbors, and our coworkers. We see them in the grocery store, we see them downtown, we see them at our places of worship. Some celebrate the choices we make, while others take issue with what we've done. We've learned this and know this to be public service. At times, a thankless job, but an essential job to our community. It's a job that each human being who is part of a city or town, I believe, should consider being a part of. And so, to each one of you who has answered the call to public service, Carrie, Pam, Blue, and Lisa, as a resident of Northampton and the vice chair of the Northampton School Committee, I say thank you to each one of you. Thank you for your commitment to doing your very best each and every day. Thank you for taking this job seriously and for striving to make decisions in the best interest of all of Northampton. and its students. Thank you very much.
Thank you. It's very nice.
So we have Laura, if you want to. She's typing away.
Motion.
She's typing Laura.
So we have for each member of the school committee, we have a certificate that just is a certificate of special recognition awarded, in this case, to Blue Duvall. It's signed by myself and Dr. Provost. And we also have a lovely hand-carved pencil, a pen that's made by high school students here, by our high school students. And each one of these has your name embossed on the case. So that's one for Ms. Duvall.
Thank you.
Ms. Hannah, we have one for you.
Thank you.
Is that nice? Thank you very much.
Yeah, with Jets.
We'll try to make sure we get Ms. Nykerchuk's to her.
High school students made this, huh? Thank you, high school students. Thank you. Yeah, I feel that.
You're welcome.
It's really nice.
So, and as it turns out, we have we also have cake and refreshments. At this point, it's approaching breakfast, so. So anyway,
I'd like to say something.
See, please do. I wanted to open the floor to the members who are leaving us to give them an opportunity to
9 minutes
to talk.
9 minutes. All right, I'll do
exactly. Yes, we do have the rules. That we have to.
We have the rules, or we'll just. Oh. I'd like to thank everybody here. First of all, it's been wonderful serving with all of you, and it's kind of an interesting position because what we do, people don't really seem to know often. They think that we have a lot more power than we really do. When in effect, what we really do is we create policies, we hire the superintendent, and we create the budget. And it seems like small, but it's a really big thing. And in order to make those decisions, I've had a wonderful time being out in the schools and going and seeing the teachers and the students and seeing everything that's happening. And I've appreciated being able to understand not only where my children have been or are at right now, but the school system as a whole. It's one thing if you go through it like I did. It's one thing if you're a parent of you know, that has kids that go through it as I am. But it's another thing to sit here and make the very, very difficult decisions and to not. The district improvement plan. I had Mr. Zahowski, Ed bring that up because I'm very, very proud of being on that committee. As a committee that decided, 35 members of our community who cared enough about our schools decided what the vision is for the next 5 years. Now, I believe in community service as a family value. My daughter serves on the Mayor's Youth Commission. We do lots of work with the homeless, and I'm not going to be gone. I may not be here in presence for the next 2 years at least, and who knows, I may run again, but I will as far as the district improvement plan, and I will as far as an understanding of our schools, and as far as questions that I now know to ask. When I just went to my third annual Massachusetts Association of School Committee conference in Hyannis, I went and I thought, wow, you know what, this is going to be cool, be different this time, I'll know so much more. But the learning curve here is incredible. I did know so much more, but I also learned that I know so much less in other ways. It's constantly changing, with No Child Left Behind turning into ESSA today. And our schools aren't something that's there. It's something that's fluid and magical and like a dance, like a movement to them. And I just want to say thank you to everybody who's been supportive, so supportive. I've had so many people come to me on the streets and, you know, apologizing for not voting. And I said, you know what? It's not. Things happen in life for a reason. And for whatever reason, I'm saddened by not continuing to be on the school committee at this time. But in another way, I'm very excited. I've already been back to helping out with the homeless down in the center of Northampton and feeding them. But there's something else to do out there, and I'm not sure what it is, but I don't think that you guys are not gonna see me again, because, I'll be at the city council meeting next week. But other than that, I still will have my, I'll be there. I'll be at home watching on the TV like I was beforehand, and that's how come I know Lisa so intimately over all these years. I've watched for so many years. And see how that, this is just a process. So I'm also a little bit scared for the school committee, and the only reason I'm scared is because with the learning curve as it is, there's four new members. That is a very, very scary idea of, because as a school committee member, we have to be very, what's that called when we can't discuss, open meeting law. So we can't really sit down, and I can't call Laura and say, hey, Laura, what about da-da-da? We all have to come up to these decisions basically on our own. And as a new school committee member 4 years ago, I remember thinking, okay, I got this, and I sat down, and I did. And about a year and a half later, something clicked, and I said, oh my gosh, I never would have voted that way. And it was one of my first or second meetings. But it's based on what we think we know and what we do know and the learning. So I would just like to encourage that all members of the school committee get into the schools as much as you can. Go out to the different functions. Volunteer. I volunteered for Bridge Street School for trans performance this last weekend. Last year. This Ryan Road for trans performance. I painted part of that mural out there. I've never done art before. I was so excited to do that. I spent my April vacation doing that. I go to Halloween parties, Memorial Day celebrations, music and chorus presentations. I've been a chaperone on many field trips. I've gone out just to watch and support. At JFK here, I've run the ice cream social and the teacher appreciation, not only for my daughter's class, but for my son years back. And being on the school committee is giving to our community, like Ed said, but it's also a matter of, there's many ways that all of us, people at home, can give to our community. Please consider running for office. Please consider being involved. Please consider giving something of yourself, because you give the littlest of yourself, it magnifies. And that we'll get to see over the next 5 years with the district improvement plan and how it comes out. And I want to give kudos to John Provost, Dr. Provost, for the district improvement, I don't know what you call it, insider. Just telling us how things are going and the progress and accountability. And I'd like to encourage people to make us all accountable, even though I'm leaving. I wanted to be accountable beforehand. You know, contact the school committee, ask them questions. But remember, all they can do is create policies, hire the superintendent, which I'm hoping he stays for a while, and create the budget, which this is the beginning of a new budget season. So there's lots of reasons to get a hold of them. But and I just want to thank the public. I want to thank the teachers. I want to thank everybody out there that's been so supportive. And there's so many people I could thank, other than my daughter, Jet. Thank Jet. I want to thank Margie Riddle. Margie Riddle has been here with me since I was a volunteer over at Ryan Road, and I was a very active volunteer for the past, you know, previous five years, and she was so instrumental in helping me understand what the position entailed and what it really was. And she's been helpful throughout the years, and even tonight she came and she had such wonderful words of encouragement. And I just want to really thank Margie, on top of all you people, on top of the constituents, on top of Dr. Prost and the mayor. But I want to thank Margie, because if there's somebody that I could say, pick one person that pushed you, Lisa Minnick, watching her on TV, motivated me. Margie Riddle was the pushing factor when I brought up how proud I was of Lisa and what she did. So I just want to let everyone know that one person can make a change. So go out and make that change and be the change you want to see in the world, as Mahatma Gandhi may say. Thank you very much for everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thanks for the cool pen. Can you see the pen?
Pam? Ms. Hammond?
It's a vote at 11 if we exceed it. So, 2 years ago, my next door neighbor, Maureen Carney, came home. She's the city council for Ward 1. She came home. She saw me on the street and said, hey, no one's running for school committee on our ward. It's really easy. You should do it. You go out and get 50 signatures, and you're in. And I was like, okay. I think it was a really sunny day. Got a lot of heat. So as I was going around getting signatures, people were like, wow, long meetings. Whoa. Wow. And it's been a good experience. I've learned a lot. And I think, I just want to share appreciation for everyone who chooses to run and participate, and just wish everyone, kind of the best of luck, and to sort of just thank all the public officials for stepping up and kind of caring about our community. So, yeah. And, I think Lisa's just a great example of that, for sticking with it for as long as she did.
quarter century.
Lisa, do you have any concluding remarks?
He didn't second.
Move to suspend
the rules. I would actually allow you, if you'd like, to make the motion to...
I actually do want to say to Pam specifically that I appreciate what you've said, but even in such a very short time on the school committee, I think you've made a difference. And it's funny because I'm the one who talks all the time, but you and Ed are the people who don't say much, but when you do, I really want to listen. Because it's usually something, you know, meaty and worth hearing. So, and I also want to say that while community service is important, I think it's a wonderful thing, and the government doesn't work without the representatives that make it a community effort. It's also important to do what's right for your family, and the choice that you've made to be more involved in your son's education, I think, is every bit as relevant and important as the decision to run for school committee. So, I don't beat yourself up, please. You've done your time. You've done your stint, and
I've been rehabilitated.
And I mean, I think it's wonderful for people to get involved. I also think it's appropriate for them to choose what's right for them and their families. So, and all of us here know what a commitment it is and what it, you know, there's a trade-off, and that's why I thanked my family. There were plenty of times that I wasn't there with them, even though they were why I wanted to do what I was doing. So please, you know, be comfortable with what you've decided to do. And like Blue said, you'll find your place in another way to contribute.
I'll get my 3 minutes at some point.
Yeah, I'll be there.
Exactly. Any other comments? Again, I'll just again thank Ms. Nykerchuk, who's not here this evening, and she worked with you, Mr. Meyer, closely on the negotiating subcommittee and made contributions to a lot of the work we've done on collective bargaining this year, and so thank her.
She too had a wonderful perspective on things. She was the one who said, "Is this really our job to be doing this?" And I'm like, "Whoa," you know, yeah. Just like cuts right through all the stuff.
With that, I'll say that our next school committee meeting is actually January 14th, 2016, where we will, this body will reconvene, having been re-sworn in again. And with that, I'll ask.
I'd like to move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? The school committee meeting is adjourned.
Since you're